Today we celebrate not only the 4th of July weekend, but also the American Le Mans Series 50th race. Over the past 5 years, we've gone from Atlanta to Australia, and now a new racetrack for the series, a circuit that has already caused a few headaches for a variety of the competitors, including Lonnie Pechnik.
Hey Lonnie, how's the grip overall on the concrete?
It's like going when you go to Rockefeller Center and you put your ice skates on and you know you go around in a circle. That's kind of what it's like.
The American Le Mans Series. Cool cars, world-class drivers, premier road courses. Born in France in 1923 with the first running of the 24 Hours of Le Mans, the ALMS is the glamour, the glory, and the grueling reality of sports car racing, European style, with American attitude. Drivers from around the world strut their speed, skill, and endurance. Four separate classes racing on the track at the same time. It is the chain that connects the new and the faithful sports car fans of an extraordinary endurance racing tradition. This is the American Le Mans Series.
Today, Lime Rock Park becomes the 18th different circuit to host a round of the American Le Mans Series. And after a three-month break, this is the second race in a week, and the teams are back in the groove and set for the New England Grand Prix. The world-famous Le Mans name has been used here in the past, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that later in the show, but it most certainly is a first here in northwestern Connecticut for the American Le Mans Series. Hello everyone, I'm Lee Diffie, along with our road racing analyst Dorsey Schrader. First up, let's talk track density. 27 cars here today on this mile-and-a-half circuit. That equates to just over 300 feet per car, but perhaps the more staggering statistic is almost 150 cars at Circuit de la Sarthe starting the 24 Hours of Le Mans. Quite staggering, Dorsey. You know this track very well. You've won on this circuit. What challenges do our competitors face today?
Well, first off, these P1 cars are going to be lapping this track a mile and a half every 47 seconds. That means they're going to lap the slower class cars about every five laps. Now, Lime Rock is like driving a 180-mile-per-hour chess match. You don't want to get trapped in places going slow. One of those places is Big Bend. If you get behind a gaggle of cars there, they'll hold you up for more than a lap. You want to be fast in the straightaways and slow in the corners, so you got to time these passes. You have to use your brain a lot around Lime Rock.
Let's introduce you to our prototype pole sitters. Here's the Audi starting grid.
Driving Rob Dyson's number 16 Loader MG with Butch Leitzinger.
I'm Brian Wilman. I drive the number 56 Team Bucknum Racing Kildeam with Chris McMurray and Jeff Bucknum.
Well, in P1, as we expected, the locally based Dyson Racing Team are bullet fast here at Lime Rock Park. They sit first and third on the grid with their lightweight Lolas sandwiching the champion Audi. And it was James Weaver who claimed his second pole position in a week here at the qualifying session on Saturday. But starting the race last week was Butch Leitzinger. And Butch, before you even saw the green flag last week, you had oil pump failure, major disappointment. You rebounded well. And I guess James wanted to see some of the fun at least today starting the car.
I think they've banned me from starting any more races after last week. But James will start and Duke go about a full hour till our pit stops, and I'll jump in for the finish. But I wasn't too popular walking back to the pits without a car.
All right, Birchall, better luck today. Well, in P2, there's big news. Jeff Bucknum claimed the P2 pole for the second week in a row, but following qualifying, they found a crack in the 3.4-litre Wilman engine, and they've had to switch to the 3-litre Nissan engine. The backup engine has less power, hopefully has the reliability to get to the checkered flag for the first time this season for that team. But now let's take a look at the production-based classes, starting with the GTS runners.
I'm Oliver Gavin. I drive the number 4 CompuWare Chevrolet Corvette. My teammate is Olivier Barretta.
I'm Mark Lieb. I'm racing the 24 McKenna Mail-to-Web Alex Trop Racing Porsche together with Romain Dumas.
Well, in GTS qualifying, it's been pretty much status quo. The Corvettes have qualified first and second. Gavin and Barretta put their number 4 Corvette on the pole, just as they did at Mid-Ohio in the last round. But if the weather changes and the rain does come in, Johnny Molum and Terry Borcheller and that Pirelli Shod Saline think that they've got something for the Bowtie Boys. GT produced one of the tightest fields we've seen in a long time. Less than a second between the top 8 cars. But if you're going to win a race, first you have to make it to the green flag. And Anthony Lazzaro getting to the green. Challenge for you. You almost lost it all in warm-up this morning. What happened?
Yeah, simple case of a guy not paying attention to the yellow flag. You know, the flag had been out for a couple laps, and he still hit me. So just a small part on mistake on his part. But the team did a really good job getting the car back together, and we're happy to be in the race today.
Well, every session is a challenge here at Lime Rock Park. The real challenge starts when the green flag drops.
And Brian, that is not too far away, but we're all sitting here at the moment as the cars roll, wondering what the weather holds in store for us this afternoon. As we show you the on-screen graphic, temperature in the low 70s, but the big thing is the bottom graphic, chance of rain, and that has certainly increased, Dorsey, over the past 5 minutes or so. The clouds are rolling in.
Yeah, I can't tell you whether it will rain or not, but what I can tell you is if it does rain, if these boys think it's slippery in the dry, they haven't been around here in the rain yet. This isn't ice skating.
If you've just joined us again, this is the first time the American Le Mans Series has raced at Lime Rock Park here in northwestern Connecticut. It's a tight, tricky circuit, but it does have high speeds. Pace car pulling off the circuit. We get set for green in this 2¾-hour race. Round three of the American Le Mans Series, the New England Grand Prix is underway.
Watch this down in turn one. Everybody's on the brakes here. You see the Corvette on the inside already, Octa.
16 gets clear of the champion Audi, and then it's the Intersport Lola diving into third spot with John Field. Duncan Dayton starting the car as he chases out after JJ Leho.
Lime Rock is a really bumpy circuit in these front two laps. These cars in the front right now, they haven't got the tire pressure built up yet, so they'll be biting out quite hard. Look there, though, the Saline already cleared into the lead.
Saline is in fifth overall in the lead GTS car. It has had a stunning weekend. Terry Borchella is starting the Asepco Saline. His regular co-driver, Johnny Mullen, they've had a couple of podiums, and they're feeling very confident about this, and he's already putting pressure on the 20.
He's trying to get by Chris Dyson right there, but really giving a lot of pressure. Like I say, though, the first few laps in these P1 cars, the pressures aren't built up in the tires, so you have to take it pretty slow.
Borchella almost threw it all the way in qualifying, trying to squeeze a little bit more out of the beautiful Saline, trying to better the time set by the two Corvettes that they are running second and third in class at the moment. And already a new leader in P2. Brian, what do you have for us?
Talk about the tires not getting up to pressure yet. It's going to take a couple of laps for that. But guys, just about the time they get to pressure, they're going to run into dampness. It's already starting to drizzle down here, and that will change everything, Dorsey.
Well, I'll tell you, it does, Brian. It says it does a lot, because a pit stop here to change tires will cost you two, maybe three laps. So if you guess wrong and you come in too early, you're going to pay a big price.
Dyson leads the way from JJ Leto. The rain starts to sprinkle. And there's been a new pit entry. There it is right there.
Probably in the
and we have lost the 43 BAM Motorsport Porsche. Contact just before the uphill.
Yes, that's a climbing turn. You're looking down at it. He's up parted to the guardrail.
There goes the New Century Mortgage Porsche as well, the racers group car. Leo Hendry in the 43 at the bottom of the hill. And at 67, Jim Matthews, one of the Intersport cars, has gone as well.
Well, the rain now claiming three cars in one lap.
They need to get that back around. Duncan Dayton doing a good job to engage reverse and limp back to the pits. Now, these guys taking it very, very easy. We're under a full course caution, in fact. James Weaver slows this field down, and pit lane will become very busy. Here's the replay of the BAM Porsche. Leo Hendry
just
wide.
Goes straight, way wide. Big hit too on that guardrail. That's the problem with Lime Rock. There's very few places you can get off on this racetrack without having a big accident.
Let's hope Leo's okay. That was a pretty heavy contact. There is the Flying Lizard Porsche. This has just happened. Starting the 44. Combination of Lonnie Pechnik, Seth Nyman, and Lonnie in the car at the moment.
Front no damage done. He's just gone and off the road because of rolling.
Leaders at start finish now.
Now here's the thing, Lee. It's pretty. You take a look and see what happened to Lonnie here in the 44. We know it's been raining. It's very slippery. There he goes off. That's just outside of the left-hander. Turn four, and he just simply spins in the wet condition.
Rain tires at the ready, understandably.
It'll be interesting to see what teams go with what choices of rain tires. There's more than one type of rain tire that they can use. And this is what makes it so hard. When you look at the sky around here, this could be just a little shower, or it could be raining for quite a while, but it looks like a shower. Hey, Brian, what do you got?
Doris, I got a question. You know, you talk about going to rain tires. Typically, you want to go to rain tires when there's standing water on the racetrack because they're so soft. They're not built to run in dry conditions. They'll overheat.
there's not a lot of standing water right now, and I wonder if going to rains is really a good decision, or an intermediate would be the choice. But a lot of teams down here, I don't see any intermediates on the wall. I'm wondering how long rains will last.
Well, that's a good point, Brian. And like I was saying, looking up at the sky, this could be just a brief shower. And if you went to full rains right now, it's such a soft compound. An intermediate rain tire is nothing more than a very, very soft compound tire. Some of them handcuffed, just they cut little sipes in there to get rid of the water. But if there's no standing water, you wouldn't want a full rain. And they would burn down very quickly. Right now, I wouldn't go to a rain tire.
Well, the key for going to rain tires for the Corvette team is they have never run on the Michelin tires, or the wet tire, that is. They've been to a couple of test sessions where it was raining, but one thing led to another. They never got out on their wet weather tires. So for those boys on the Corvette team, if they do run the Michelin wet today, that'll be a whole new experience for them. And as I stand here, I believe it is the number 16 of James Weaver. It is the race leader now coming down into pit lane. They have the Goodyear wet weather tire at the ready. And being honest about this, talking to some of these drivers on the team, they were hoping for dry conditions. They feel that the new Goodyear slick tire they have is excellent, but the rain tire may certainly have a disadvantage to the Michelin tire on the Audi. But they're making that call. They just want to keep it safe. When you're running around, Dorsey, on these conditions on slick tires, it is literally like being on ice, as you know.
Oh, absolutely right there. I said before, I've driven this racetrack many times in the wet, and it is very, very slippery.
What an introduction to the teams and competitors of the American Le Mans Series. Never at Lime Rock have they run. Now they have to run in the rain. It will be a spectacular day, and they will be running. Channel's coverage of the New England Grand Prix is brought to you by Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires. And by Audi. In technology, performance and design, our goal remains constant. Never follow.
You're watching the New England Grand Prix, beautiful area of North America here in northwestern Connecticut. However, the weather is not cooperating today for this wonderful crowd. It's been fine for the majority of the weekend and for the majority of the day. And it is a very challenging day, especially for the tire manufacturers.
When the racing tire division of Michelin come to a race, they have no idea of knowing what the weather's going to be. Is it going to be wet or is it going to be dry? Is it going to be hot? Is it going to be cold? As a result, they have to bring a lot of tires. Now, if it was a cool day, you'd want this very soft compound tire. It would give you a lot of speed. On the other hand, if it gets warmer, you might have to switch to the harder compound for longevity. In the rain, if it's only raining a little, you'd go to this tire. It's a very soft compound tire. It's an intermediate. But in a hard downpour, maybe this one. It's a full-treaded rain tire. However, in standing water, a deluge, this tire has been hand-cut. It opened up the tread sipes. This would be the better tire in a deluge. However, with all that being said, they had to bring 2,000 tires to this race just to service 12 cars.
And of course, that's Michelin. That's just one of many tire manufacturers involved in the American Le Mans Series. Have a look at this. This is what they do for a weekend. 22 American Le Mans Series representatives, 9 fitters. You can read the rest for yourself. But I think the most amazing one there, Dorsey, is 2,000 tires.
Yeah, and that's for, again, just for only 12 of these cars on the Michelins. There's 8 different teams that are sponsored by Michelin here.
They've been scrambling down in pit lane, and Calvin and Brian can tell us more. Cal?
Well, when we talk about JJ Leto, I said that's like driving on ice with these conditions. Well, he has done some ice racing in the past, so he's certainly used to this type of conditions. He's going to keep out there and try and see. As we look over the hills right now, we do see some better weather approaching in our direction, so the team has decided they don't want to come in, lose track position. They're just going to try and keep it safe. Hopefully, JJ can keep it on the island. The Corvette team, well, they've changed tires down here about 3 times. They've been switching between the wet, the intermediate, and now they've got the intermediates at the ready, because the rain is definitely easing up, and I do see some sunshine as I speak. Let's go down to Brian Tell.
Calvin, most of the cars down on this end of pit road, the racers group cars, they all went to rain tires. The only car that stayed on slicks was the number 35 Risi Competizione Ferrari. They came in, topped off with fuel, but left the slicks on. The PK Porsche Sport guys, they went to an intermediate tire, and as you said, it's starting to clear up back to the west, so you got to wonder, how long are those rain tires going to last? This is a decision right now. It's going to be very tough for these guys to make, and hopefully they made the right one. Dorsey, you said it, this racetrack very slick. You want the confidence and the comfort of that very sticky rain tire, but you'll burn them off in five laps if it dries out.
Yeah, you will indeed. What you would want to do, if it's my choice right now, I would have stayed on slick, and I would just be very, very careful for a few laps, because if you go the other way, you're going to have to make a green flag stop.
Working our way back to the green. What an eventful start here at Lime Rock Park.
Nobody lost a lap there because we were under yellow, so all these choices that were made, you're stuck with them now, because if you've gone with the rain, say, and it dries out, and you have to come in under green, you're going down two laps for that decision.
Calvin?
Well, you see here a sign from the Corvette team to Ollie Gavin's mother. She hasn't watched Ollie in live action, actually been at the racetrack for over 3 years. She came here this weekend, but she had a slight medical condition. They've had to take her to the hospital in Providence. I hope she's doing well. The team's thoughts and wishes are with Ollie Gavin's mother right now. Let's go down to Brian once again.
Under this yellow team, Bucknum taking advantage of the continuing yellow flag. Bucknum, Willman, and McMurray, they brought the car back in. They had brought it in a little while ago, topped it off with fuel, and put reins on it. But they, too, I believe, looked back to the west and saw the clearing skies. They brought it back in, and they've gone back to slick tires.
JJ Leto leads the way, obviously, overall. In P2, Clint Field leads the way. There he is. And the GT class leading car is the 79 of British driver Tim Sugden. The J3 Racing Group team with Justin Jackson. Top 10 result at Mid-Ohio for those guys as we work our way back to green.
Green.
JJ Leto leads the field away, but he's got Chris Dyson, the local lad, right with him.
See what it's like down here in the brakes zone. I'd be very cautious. We just saw Buckland's car come out of the pits. It's not that far in front. He'll be going a lap down if he doesn't get it done pretty quick.
The ADT champion Audi clears out, but we'll be being very cautious as the four Corvette with Olivier Beretta behind the wheel runs a little wide through the left-hand and chasing hard near Simco Saline.
And there are no slow corners at Lime Rock. This is a momentum track, a mile and a half, if you will, but you do 115 mile per hour average around this mile and a half.
I don't think this has got Corvette's attention with the Saline being up front. It most certainly has, and Beretta putting plenty of pressure on Terry Borchella immediately. They worked very hard at the previous round of Mid-Ohio to get that podium spot. A thrilling finish with Johnny Molan chasing down David Brabham in the Lamborghini Murcielago. Catching him right at the end. Now look at this. Here comes the sister Corvette and the 16 with James Weaver flying down the inside.
Surprisingly enough, all these drivers have chosen to stay on the dry line. What I'm talking about right there is where they're putting a race car on the racetrack. They're driving it as if it was totally dry. In a wet line, you would go to the outside more and utilize the outside of the racetrack, which has more grip.
You see JJ Leto right now, Dorsey, disappearing into the distance. Some of that is certainly experience from the younger Chris Dyson, but some of it is the tires. The Michelin tire definitely comes up to temperature much faster than the Goodyear tire. The Dyson team were looking at that in the morning warm-up. They said JJ was up to speed within about two laps. It was taking six laps to get the same tire temperature and ultimately the same speed. So I think that gap should even out a little bit once Chris Dyson gets some temperature into his Goodyear rubber.
I spoke to JJ right before the race start, and I said, so how do you find it? And he said, I actually think this place is a lot better than what I thought it was going to be. A lot of people complaining about the lack of grip and particularly the bumps. But JJ said, I don't mind it too badly at all.
You know, with you're out there driving and you're on these tires, you're not up to temperature, up to pressure, you're a sitting duck. I mean, you're bottoming out really hard, you just have to stay with it. And a four-lap advantage with the one tire coming in over the Goodyears, that's a big advantage to have. Because you can't be aggressive until those tires get up to temperature.
P1 points leader is the race leader to the tune of about 6 seconds over Chris Dyson as he carves his way through the P2 class. The battle in GTS rages here. Saline versus Corvette. Whoa, Beretta thought about it on the inside, heading up to the chicane.
Yeah, that's a bad place to pass. Even if you could, it'd be a bad place. And it's because what I was saying before, it slows you up too much. You don't want to make a pass there. What you want to do is get this run right here on this downhill. Get the run going here and pass down this long straight. Oh, loose. It's
Celine gets very good.
And James Weaver brings it back into pit lane. Olivier Beretta has the run on the inside. Look at this, almost three abreast down into one. And Beretta, both Corvettes go through on the inside.
And then right behind that is that beautiful Lamborghini. Brand new second race out of the box for that car.
Fabulous to see all four GTS cars running line astern. There's only one car left in the GTS class that's not in this battle. Cal.
Well, James Weaver has brought the car back in. Of course, they went to the full wet weather tyre, which is really not the tyre right now. It's dried out really quickly here, so they're going to peel this rubber off. We'll try and get a good look there. It doesn't look too bad as we try and take a close look there at that left front tyre. You can see it's starting to chew up a little bit, so they're going back to slick tyres. But with this very short racetrack, they predicted that you'd lose about a lap and a half for a car staying out under green conditions. So James Weaver has the fuel in the car, tyres on, he's back underway.
Well, there was the mistake I was telling you about. That just takes our pole sitter and puts him one lap down. He's not up to speed yet, so it could be two laps.
He re-enters just ahead of this GTS battle. And that just shows you how much time you do lose, as the boys were talking about. He was in the middle of this scrap last time around. So James Weaver and Butch Leitzinger behind the eight ball. Olivier Beretta, Ron Fellows ganged up on Terry Porcello very successfully. They've got through into first and second in GTS. Porcello now third. And the Lamborghini with David Brabham behind the wheel. We mentioned earlier in that thrilling battle at the end of Mid-Ohio. Just got bumped off the podium. Well, the 50th American Le Mans Series race here at Lime Rock Park today. Cake for Dr. Don Panos, the founder of the series, and everybody celebrating here on July 4 weekend. Back live and exclusive here on Speed Channel, the New England Grand Prix continues, and here is your Prototype 1 P1 and overall class leader. Two races so far this season, two different P1 winners. Let's bring you up to date. The series kicked off in the beautiful Florida sunshine with the Mobil 1 12 hours of Sebring, and it was a titanic struggle and scrap between the ADT champion Audi team and the Velox Audi team. In the end, it was Alan McNish, Pierre Kaffa, and Frank Bieler taking victory in Florida. Marvelous race between those two teams, and then just a week ago, we lost our pole-sitting car, Butch Leitzinger, drove the 16 Dyson Lola off the side of the circuit. And this was a thrilling battle between Andy Wallace and Marco Werner. Dyson versus champion. It was Werner on Wallace, Wallace on Werner. This went on for the whole first stint. Pit stop came in, Chris Dyson went behind the wheel, unfortunately spun, handed the lead and the win to JJ Lado. Marco Werner winning their first race of the year in the American Le Mans Series. Points look like this. Lado, Werner have a 12-point margin over Andy Wallace, and then Bieler and Kaffa, thanks to their victory at the 12 hours of Sebring, back there in third place. And that is exactly how they sit at the moment, with Werner, Lado leading the way over the car driven by Andy Wallace, who is 12 points adrift of them in the championship. You look at the ADT champion Audi now through the chicane at the top of the hill. Let's take it back to GT in a wonderful effort so far. This will come down to staying out as well. Tim Sutton in the 79 J3 car.
Yeah, like I said, the right choice was to wait it out. Just reduce your speed, stay on the slick for those people who went to full range. They're paying a big price. And of course, the biggest one is James Weaver. Now it's a lap down, but I'm going to tell you something about James Weaver. He's on the prowl. He's running a lap time 2 seconds quicker than anybody in the field right now. He's running 51-second laps.
Sugden comes through and laps the PK Sport car. And he's mixing it up with the P2 class cars.
Ooh, a little touch there, I think.
He and James trying to force his way through on the inside past the Bannister car. Tell us more about some of the other GT class cars.
Well, as Dorsey said, you should have waited it out. This is what the wet weather tyre looks like brand new. This is what it looks like after about six laps on the car with Romain Dumas behind the wheel in the pole sitting 24 machine. You see, it's absolutely destroyed this wet weather Michelin tire. What you have here are the tire blocks. Once the track dries out, these really start to squirm, overheat, and it just peels this rubber back. And when you get to that stage, it's like driving on ice once again. So they have a small window to work in. They obviously exceeded that, Lee.
Talking GT for a moment longer, and the Panos GT LM car has come to a stop out on the side of the circuit. Gunnar Jeanette just literally driving off to the side of the circuit. So it could be day done for those guys, unfortunately. Meanwhile, Tim Sugden goes from strength to strength. He leads the GT class. Ralph Kellner's in the Risi Ferrari, sits second at the moment. And these GT cars you're seeing on screen here are trying desperately to make up time on this car here, the J3 Porsche of Tim Sugden, hugely experienced competitor from the UK, runs the British GT Championship at the moment. He's leading that championship. FIA GT, he's had a Le Mans experience, very, very fast. Here's the second place GT car, Ralph Kellner, behind the wheel of the 360 Modena.
Luckily for those guys, they did a lot of work at the front end after that mistake this morning, and put a new front foot on. Now the fender doesn't fit quite as nicely as it could, but it's not giving them any trouble yet.
Ryan, can you add on this car?
Rick Mayer is the engineer on the 35 car. Rick, you guys had tough decisions to make all weekend long, but maybe the toughest was the tire choice. It seems to be the right one.
Yeah, I hope so. It looked like it was clearing, and we just took the chance. We took the extra lap around to make sure that it was the right choice. If you have to pit at a green here, you're going to lose two laps and be ugly. So I think we're in good shape now.
Well, these guys wanted a break all weekend long. They had trouble. We saw that earlier in warm-up. They may have gotten the break that they needed, Lee.
From GT to P1, and flying around the track is the 16 Dyson Mola of James Weaver. He is one lap down, but running very quick lap times in the low 50s and trying desperately to make his way back. Here he is now coming up on the Intersport Mola, the combination of Duncan Dayton and John Field, who are really looking forward to a break in their life this weekend here at Lime Rock. Talking with James, he was having a bit of a giggle before the start of the race with you and I, Dawson, wasn't he? He said, everyone thinks that we, meaning Dyson, are complete experts here at Lime Rock, but he said, we haven't tested here much at all because there was no point because it was never on the schedule.
Now, the Dyson cars have always run longer. They haven't been set up here. You can see the compliancy. Just looking at the 16, they're just watching on the rough side.
Minus one lap in 26 seconds.
That was Bob Leitzinger giving James the information he's needed.
Keep it hustling.
Yeah, he's got the pedal to the metal. He's gotten by the field car now. It was the quickest run on the track, but not that time. J.J. Lato was spotted with a 1 second lap. Uh-oh, field off the top of the uphill. No damage, almost got the guard rail. I don't think he hit it, though.
Oh.
That was a close one.
And the margin for error here at Lime Rock Park is very, very small. Anxious moment for Duncan Dayton. And a lucky escape. Here's the replay.
Oh, he's missed the chicane. That's top of the hill. He's gone around the outside of the chicane, almost gotten into the wall.
Able to rejoin. Everything's okay for Dayton. Continues on. It's Lato leading the way by 22 seconds over Chris Dyson for Dyson Racing in second. Third in the P1 class is James Weaver. GTS class leaders, it's Olivier Beretta for Corvette over Ron Fellows and Terry Borchella. And P2 is being led by Clint Field over Andy Lally at the moment. This is how it looks in P1. Stay with us, more from Lime Rock when we return. Well, how things can change so quickly. A beautiful day now here at Lakeville, Connecticut. Time to bring you up to date with what has transpired in the GTS Championship today in the opening two rounds. Sebring, we saw the debut of the beautiful new Asemco Saleen taking on Corvettes, and it was a rough old day for the four. Rob Barth getting into the side of Jan Magnussen. He took it back into the pit lane. Ollie Gavin took over, but a severe clutch problem put them out of the race. And it was a dream run for the number three, Mad Max Pappas, Johnny O and Ron Fellows winning the Mobil 1 12 Hours of Sebring in the GTS class. At Mid-Ohio, the four, Ollie Gavin and Olivier Beretta, took the fight for these guys. So the number three, they had contact with the Saleem early on, and then due to caution, it put them on the tail of the lead lap, and the three just kept on cruising. And back-to-back wins for Ronnie and Johnny. They did a nice job. GTS points look like this at the moment. There's a 14-point margin back to that Asimco Saleem behind Fellows and O'Connell. Brabham sitting there further 17 back in the new Lamborghini Murcielago. Class-leading car here since third overall is the man from Monaco, Olivier Beretta. Had to hustle early on to get by the Asimco Ferrari, but now Beretta has increased his margin.
Right now we lost our car TV. By about 8 seconds. We cannot see. You must use your mirrors.
Yeah, that radio communication there, Dorsey, use your mirrors. That is paramount here in Lime Rock.
Yeah, that's why I say it's part of the chess match. You have to be able to see out the front and out the back to see how you have to work hand in hand with you. If you got a faster car coming up from behind, you want to let him pass you to a place where it doesn't slow both of you up.
Well, they checked in with the 63 car, Terry Borcheller. They said the car is doing very well. They're pleased with his progress right now, especially on this bumpy Lime Rock circuit. The only problem that they have, Terry's cool suit has stopped working. And Dorsey, as you know, around this racetrack, especially with this high humidity right now, he's a baked potato inside that Saleem. It's got to be uncomfortable.
Well, you're not kidding. When a cool suit fails, and what that is, it's a suit that you wear underneath your driver's suit that pumps ice water through little veins to keep you cool. When that does not work, it's like one extra insulation layer that makes you really uncomfortably hot. And this, Lime Rock, is one very physical racetrack on the driver. It's very rough, and you're never in a straight line very long to determine the braking concept.
Just to finish off that point about the Olivier Beretta, he was told to use his mirrors. The reason why is that unique system they have set up in the Corvette where there is a tiny television monitor inside the cockpit and there's a camera facing rear bumper. They have lost the TV feed within the car. And that's why the team were telling him to use your mirrors instead of the monitor.
These cars are really hard to see out the back of because of the rear wing and the rear spoiler. You know, you look out the rear view mirror of your street car, you don't have that big wing sitting there. So even if you're looking through the back, you can't see much. That's why they have that television system. Without it working in a place like Lime Rock, ooh, he's going to be busy today.
Lato now has a 40-second lead over Chris Dyson and is flying. The Finn is down into the 49-second range. Things looking good at the moment as the sun shines here at Lime Rock for the ADT Champion Audi team. Chris Dyson sits second overall, and it's Beretta third overall, lead GTS car. Here is the sister Dyson Lola. James Weaver trying to get his way back, and here is Leto. Marco Werner at the ready, as usual, to take over and try for back-to-back wins. They did it at Mid-Ohio, looking to do it for the second time in 8 days.
Well, we heard team owner Rob Dyson, Chris's father, tell him, step up the pace. The Audi's coming. He's not even a half a lap behind you. And we've gotten James Weaver a lap down. So you tell him, Chris, right now, you're carrying the ball for the team. Get running. Said that done when you got this man, J.K. Lato, running 49-second laps around here.
I think you meant to say that the 16 is coming on the Audi. Weaver's coming. He is flying.
Yeah, they're both coming, unfortunately. He's going to find that out very shortly.
Traffic has been pretty kind so far to the prototypes. They've done a good job. We've seen limited incidents, that's for sure. Just a reminder, each and every Monday night here on Speed, at 7 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. Pacific, inside Nextel Cup. Join the boys, Alan Beswick and the gang, as they dissect everything that occurred on the previous weekend in Nextel Cup racing. It is still Tim Sugden who leads the way for J3 in the GT class. Lato up front. Former Le Mans 24-hour winner J.J. Lato has his foot to the floor, chasing Chris Dyson, trying to lap the second-place car. That's P1. Let's talk P2 for a moment and reflect on the two rounds so far. The Mobil 1 12 Hours at Sebring, one of the new teams to the American Le Mans Series, Miracle Motorsports, with Ian James, Mike Borkowski, John Macaluso, got off to a tremendous start. but Scott Bradley, Jason Workman, Bobby Sachs, they also did a pretty good job in chasing them down, but it was that successful trio for Miracle winning in Sebring. At the Mid-Ohio Sports Car Course, tough break for the class Pole City car. They went out on the opening lap, but for Le Mans 24-hour P2 class winner Clint Field, the boy from Dublin, Ohio, won with first-time race winner and class winner Robin Liddell. Back here live now at Mid-Ohio, quick review of the points. Ian James leads the way just over his teammate James Gioi, and Mike Borkowski, John Macaluso, a further 13 back from those guys. Ian James having one of the best racing years of his career. The 67 New Century Mortgage Racers Group Porsche, Jim Matthews, Pierre Herret. It's been a very eventful day for those guys, flat right rear.
Yeah, all the way cut down right rear, you see that. This is the new pit in. We didn't discuss it, but there's a brand new pit in right here. They brought it further down the pit lane. It's a much more abrupt corner than it used to be.
They've done that to accommodate the cars here in the American Le Mans Series, make it a little bit more workable and comfortable for the teams. Here's Clint Field, getting the back-to-back wins in the P2 class. It's been an amazing past month for this guy, not only celebrating his 21st birthday, but winning at the 24 Hours of Le Mans, then coming home and winning in his home state, just up the road from home at Mid-Ohio. Teamed with Michael Duran here this weekend.
It's really developed into a very good driver. You know, he started so young, and he's become one of the best, really good driver now.
What does that do for your confidence and for your career, but particularly for your confidence winning at Le Mans?
Well, I mean, I talked to Clint, and he's still beaming. You can just, as soon as you bring the subject up, he's just completely, you know, it's the biggest win that maybe he'll ever get. Who knows? I mean, that's a huge accomplishment at 21 years of age.
Jeff Bucknam in the Pilbeam Nissan, running second in class. These guys would not believe their bad luck so far at Sebring and at Mid-Ohio. Mid-Ohio particularly, two stops so far, just over 3 minutes in the pits. And you need to keep that time in the pits the lowest number known
yeah,
possible.
Do. Bucknam's car at Mid-Ohio is a candidate ignition switch, but everybody switched this shut off and was brought, there's a broken piece inside. It's just one of those things, one of those racing things that drives you nuts. Nobody's home.
Have to say that today, as we see the 79 J3 Porsche go through shot there, that this is the best chance for the Ferrari to win in GT. Sutton leads that class at the moment, but the Ferrari with Ralph Cohen is second. There is the 67 getting back up to speed. Keep in mind that it was a tough start to the day for the 19. Whoa, this is what happened to Jim Matthews.
Well, they've done it again. Another contact down there in turn one.
That's the 19, the P2 prototype, the Vandersteur team. And the 13 machine of Andy Lally and Ryan Eversley. Back in the lane. That's released now. They get back out on it. A little over 2 hours remaining. It's been an eventful first 40 minutes, that's for sure, with clouds, rain, now sunshine and nice dry conditions. We were talking about Clint Field. Let's catch up with his teammate, Mike Duran.
Mike, Clint is on quite a roll. He won the 24 Hours in class. He won at Mid-Ohio. You're now his teammate this weekend. Do you feel any pressure?
Well, obviously, it's a lot of pressure. Clint's done a great job the last two races, and they brought me on for this race. It's kind of my home track here in Boston. So hopefully everything's going to go well. We're in a good place right now. We didn't pit when the rain started coming, so we gained a lot of spots. And so far, things going great.
Okay, things are smooth for this team, but another team having problems, Lee.
Well, we just mentioned Ryan Eversley taking over from Andy Lally, and Ryan has ended up in the deep, deep grass. That is your P2 class leading car. But for Eversley, you saw he ran off the circuit. Just on behind him was the
And he won't be able to get out of there either, because that's very swampy down there. So this could bring out a full course caution at some point. He's straight in off of the left-hander, and that's where people go if you lock up the brake just a little bit. There's no way he's going to drive out of there.
He doesn't think they're going to do
it. That shows you the elevation.
They're not
going
to pull me out, Jason. What do we do here? I'm stuck in the mud, apparently. They won't pull me out. We're going yellow. They're closing the pit.
There you hear it. We're going to get the full course. There it is.
Second caution of the day.
And they will pull them out of there.
Turn the car off. Just wait. If pull you out, we can come back around and get going again. But if they don't, I guess. So don't get out of the car.
Camera stand, copy.
Now watch the scrambling pit lane as well. This will give some teams some opportunity to make up ground, others perhaps not. We'll take a quick commercial break during our second caution and go racing after this. Welcome back to Lime Rock Park as the New England Grand Prix continues round three of the American Le Mans Series, and you're looking at young Ryan Eversley and the race car company entry needing to be towed out of that boggy swamp area down there. He had just come out of pit lane and could not pull that car up and ran straight off course. Let's join Brian Till with his teammate, Andy Lally.
Well, Andy Lally had just handed the car over to Ryan. Andy, very difficult conditions, first of all, out there. The wet, the dry, and the traffic. Which one was more difficult?
The most difficult one just now, actually, was chose to go with rains, and that obviously wasn't it. As soon as we put the rains on, pulled out of pit lane, it got sunny, so I tried to do as many laps as I could on the wets, and they were just getting torn up, and so we had to pit it under green. Ryan had a little problem just now, I guess right when he went out, somebody pushed him wide going into one of the corners, I think the left-hander out there, so I just hope if we can get it back in. I'm not sure under the rules if we get a tow out of the muck out there, if we can get it going again, but we'll give it our best shot.
Well, they need to run for at least 45 minutes to get points, and that's what he was alluding to. They need those points for the championship. Tough luck for these guys here, but very challenging conditions today, Lee.
Thanks, Brian. Let's have a look at the replay of what exactly happened to Ryan, Andy Lally's teammate. Talk us through, Dorsey.
Oh, right here, coming up to the left-hander. He's gone through the big bend, turn one. Just gets wide, locks up. Nobody pushed him off. He just made a mistake. Drove off on cold tires, and you see, once you get to that point, there's no return. I know that. Watch this. He's going to sink.
Whoa.
I've been in there before.
And that is exactly the same place if you saw the Speed World Challenge a few weeks back when Max Angelelli went in there and just got swamped. It was full of water that time around. The way it stands at the moment, JJ Leto leads by a lap over Chris Dyson, and Chris has brought the Dyson Lola into pit lane, right in front of the GTS leading car with Olivier Beretta. Dyson is in, driver change, Andy Wallace standing by. Cal is with Olivier Beretta and the Corvette team.
Well, the leader in the GTS class has pitted. Olivier Beretta turned over to Ollie Gavin, and this team looked to be in pretty good control. We did hear of a report of the number three car taking a hit during that caution period under the rain conditions. Ron Fellows hit the 71 and passed him and then hit him in the door, but no problem. Fueling is now done on the car. Just a reminder, under these ALMS regulations, no servicing until the fueling is complete. Then the car can come off the jacks. The team go to work. Fresh set of Michelins for Ollie Gavin. Let's go down to Brian Till.
Now the GT leader, Tim Sugden, just came in. Fuel only, he left the Michelins on, and right behind them, the 35 Risi Competizione car is in. He took fuel tires. Lazaro will take over. They also made a change to the rear gurney on the 35 car to get back out. Lee?
This will be a thrilling battle. These are the two cars on the same lap, on the lead lap in the GT class.
Good job, guys. Nice job. Quickly stop.
As we hear, Andy Wallace has strapped in the 20 for Chris Dyson. This is Anthony Lazaro, former Toyota Atlantic champion, bringing out the Risi Ferrari. And again, we have to stress that this could be the Ferrari's best chance at winning the GT class. Four different classes in the American Le Mans Series, all racing at the same time. And this is what's happened in the GT class today. At Sebring, of course, the Alex Job Porsches were expected to do well. The domineering team in American Le Mans Series racing. A different driver lineup though this year, and it was the 24 of Timo Bernard, Jörg Bergmeister, and Sascha Massin. Bergmeister was too ill to drive. There was a vent out on the track. The Alex Job Porsches remained unscathed, and Bernard and Sascha Massin stood on the top step of the podium. At Mid-Ohio, though, the tables were turned, and the Joe cars did not have it all their own way. Brand new team to the American Le Mans Series, Flying Lizard Racing, with Darren Law and Johannes van Overbeek, took the fight to them and passed them. Law getting his first ALMS win, Van Overbeck his second, and the points are tight. There's only 6 points separating Timo Bernard up there all by himself, Van Overbeck and Darren Law in that chase.
Well, you're not going to believe this. What's happened while we were looking there is that the pace car is going to bring the field down, take the green, and the champion Audi never did pit, so now he's going to have to pit on the green.
There he comes, straight in, straight away. He did have a one lap buffer though.
Oh, here comes the dice, boys.
Now his pressure is over. Wow! Big hook up by the field car. Down into turn one, was able to keep it on at Big Ben.
James Weaver will be on kill to get that lap back. Calvin?
Well, this was a huge mistake. Mike Peters and Brad Kettler were discussing, we need to know when it's going to go green, then we'll bring him in at the last possible moment. And you want to extend the window, but I think they were also trying to make sure that James Weaver didn't get his lap back and then be able to pit. So there's a lot of strategy going on here. They certainly left a lap too long, and this is going to literally cost them a lap on the racetrack. Big mistake, the race is back on, boys.
Most certainly is, and James Weaver in the 16, absolutely flying. You have to remember just what a significant event this is for the team. Rob Dyson and all of his staff from Poughkeepsie just up the road. He comes onto the main straight. The Dyson car is still on pit lane. And James Weaver.
Now there's
Dyson coming out behind him.
Here we go. The race is on.
Weaver with his lap back now will be on full kill. That's exactly what he needed.
That got James his lap back. He's 43 seconds in arrears now. And trouble for one of the flying lizard Porsches in the BK Sport Porsche down in Big Bend. It looked like it was the 45. That
out the car. Fine, no damage. Watch, he's right behind you again, Johannes.
And that is Thomas Blom, the team strategist, talking to Johannes Van Overbeck.
Have it off like that down there, you have to get your regroup, you got to get your head back on your shoulders quickly. You know, he's got to get back
up to speed.
You know
how the tires are as quickly as you can.
Here's a problem up in the chicane right now.
19. And the Stir car back in trouble. 16 now leads the way.
That car's been in trouble all day long from this morning. James Weaver, wow, I told you, look at that. Now we've got a new leader, Weaver in the front.
These tires.
Look at the GC strap on here. These guys all playing catch up to the J3 Porsche and the racing Ferrari. Huge pack of Porsches there, and the prototypes trying to work their way through. That looks like our race leader is a
Weaver.
That's
what I talked about at the beginning of the show. That was Big Ben, and he's now behind the gaggle of Porsches with nowhere to go. That's 5th, 5th, 6th, and last. And he's strapped in 20 behind this costume. A lot of time.
Trying to get past 3rd, 4th, and 5th in the GT class.
Porsche.
One thing he is doing is he is being very patient.
Well, he's got to be patient. There's nothing to do. These guys are racing in position. Now he'll be able to get by them.
Gets a quick opportunity to gas it.
That probably cost him 5 seconds on that lap. That's what happens here at Lime Rock.
We'll wait for our timing and scoring to cycle through for another lap. Last time round, Weaver had an 8-second margin over Marco Werner. The Dyson Lola up against the ADT champion Audi.
Well, isn't that something? Both of these guys losing laps, too bad positions in the pits. Now it's back like nothing's happened. They're both on the lead lap.
What a comeback for the 16. This is interesting stuff now.
It really is. And JJ later looks at the scoring monitor. I don't think you can believe that Weaver's back in the lead. He made a great call on staying out on slicks when it started to sprinkle. But talk about the call to stay out there till the green flew.
Well, we talked about it, but you know, it was just drizzling. You know, I have been seeing much heavier rains. You know, I was surprised that if somebody came in, like car number 16 from Dyson, you know, they came in for wets. And that was definitely a bad call because I looked at the sky all the time and it was getting clear and blue again, so it wouldn't have taken a long time to get it dry again. I mean, the circuit is really, the surface is so rough that it dries out quick.
What about the call you just made though? You and the team in determining to stay out a little bit longer under caution, Weaver immediately got the lap back.
Well, unfortunately, but I think that was a time issue. Because minimum time for the driver is 45 minutes, and I think that we were very close to, for that, so I think that's why we had to stay out for a little bit longer. And okay, it just started to get green lap, so we didn't really lose everything, but we lost a little bit too much.
he's given us the diplomatic answer there. It's an interesting call. I spoke to Brad Kettler. He said, there's no way Weaver may follow us in. Obviously, he didn't. They're on a different strategy. Remember, by them pitting under yellow, that extended their pit window just a little bit, but he's probably only got about half a dozen laps left in the tank.
Drama down in turn one as well for the Lamborghini Murcielago. Peter Cox behind the wheel.
I don't know if it is quite hot. The steering is completely out. We have to come in.
Sideways down in turn one, and you hear him saying, I'm going to have to come back into pit lane. Let's have a look at a replay what exactly happened down there. Contact by the looks of it between the Asemco Saleen.
Yeah, the Saleen got into the back of the Lamborghini. Just got him enough to turn around.
The last couple of laps, I can tell you, between first and second, James Weaver did have an 8-second lead over Marco Werner. Here is your race-leading car. Then it went down to 6.5 seconds, but traffic has played into that. Marco Werner now responds. He's only 6.2 seconds behind. So Werner, the German, chasing the Brit. It's champion versus Dyson. Thrilling battle for the crowd on the hill here at Lime Rock. Eventful race here at Lime Rock Park so far for the New England Grand Prix. The Dyson Lola starting on pole position, and within moments of the green flying, rain came down, and James Weaver and the team brought the 16 into change for wet weather tyres. As you can see, questionable decision considering how quickly the sun came back out. Tremendous scrap in GTS with Terry Borchella in the two Corvettes. Olivier Beretta and Roth Fellows really putting the pressure on, and they were able to get by the Saleen down in turn one. Leo Hendry, huge contact in the BAM Porsche just before the uphill. The Flying Lizard car, contact as well. The Panos GT with Gunnar Jett behind the wheel retiring, and then it was time to swap it all over again. Weaver, you saw, diving into pit lane there. They went back out on the slicks, and he was able to get his lap back with a bit of a dodgy decision from the champion Audi team. There is now only 6.5 seconds separating those two cars. Leaderboards at the moment, it's Weaver over Werner, over Wallace, and Duncan Dayton fourth in P1. P2 looks like this. Mike Durand and Jeff Buckner are having a thrilling scrap out there. There's only half a second between those guys, and then Ian James for Miracle Motorsports is third. In GTS, it's Ron Fellows, who has quite a substantial gap, 18 seconds over Ollie Gavin, and the Saleen, Johnny Molum, now behind the wheel, runs third in that class. And in GT, we've now got the top half dozen or so on the lead lap, and they're starting to hone in on Sutton and Lazzaro. Dave Murray, the first in that order, chasing the Ferrari and the Porsche up front. But here we have the scrap in P2. It's the Intersport Bowl with Mike Duran, as you heard him say earlier. This is his home event. He is fending off a very determined Jeff Buckner.
And that's the overall leader, just about to put a lap on him.
Whips by.
James Weaver gets between them there. That's the first he's been looking hard for the last 10 laps.
He's been running for 57 laps, and I have been very surprised by the lack of contact here. We were all kind of fearing it, that traffic was going to come to play. Perhaps there could be some nasty-looking incidents, but it's been smooth so far.
I think these guys have been had a talk to probably about using your head around this racetrack. You can lose it all, or you're real quick.
Let's get it down to the pits. Cal, what do you have for us?
Chris Dyson currently running third with teammate Andy Wallace. Chris, talk us through what it's like driving one of these cars on slicks when it started to rain on you.
Well, the track was hot enough that it didn't really get saturated, but it was greasy enough on the concrete patches that it was pretty miserable at the start. I think JJ had the edge on us when the conditions were changing, and then once by the time the gap stabilized a bit, the car came back to us a bit. So, it's definitely a handful around here, especially with the traffic. Busy.
You made the call to stay out, James. If not, they're playing catch-up now, but with champion pitting there as we went back to green, the game is back on. Can you boys do it on one more stop? I thought he was light on fuel, but I understand from the team he may be able to go the rest of the distance on just one more stop.
Well, I know for us, for Andy and I, we're just going to do one more fuel stop, and James is going to have to hand off the Butch somewhere along the line. So hopefully we can catch a yellow, and they won't catch a yellow.
There you have it. A lot going on here. This short racetrack strategy is a nightmare for these team engineers.
Dyson, third place car in the lineup with Andy Wallace behind the wheel.
We were talking to James Weaver right before the start of this race, and he said they could run 3 to 4 laps longer than what the Audi guys would be able to run. So that puts him in the window, or maybe not, but it's going to be close.
this man, this car on screen, is just 37 seconds out of the lead, the sister Dyson Lola. Some more Porsches to tangle with up here. One of the J3 cars, both of the Flying Lizard Porsches.
That's what you hate to see when you look up ahead there. There's all that Porsche brigade. They're all racing for position, so they have the right to the racetrack. But when you're trying to get by them, boy, it's hard.
Big off here. It's a prototype.
That's a big wreck.
That is big, big. And it's Mike Durand. Mike Durand in the Intersport Lola was the class-leading P2 car.
Well, you see, he's out of the car. That's good to see. Got out on his own there, talking with the corner marshal. But that is a very big accident right there.
That is the brand new car for this year, and that car is seriously damaged.
The exit of West Bend on the approach to the downhill, they're going down right there. So you're well over 100 miles an hour when you get to that part of the racetrack.
Full course caution. Let's have a look at a replay of Michael Durand's crash exiting West Bend. Watch to the right of your screen.
Oh, dear.
Whoa.
Just a huge off. Head on into the barrier.
However, I think there are still tires that far up, so he contacted tires rather than metal.
So he hit like on the end of the rubber right there. You see the car is not going anywhere today. That's it for that car. That's a shame.
So the dream run for Clint Field has come to an end.
Such a good scrap going for the lead, but you just saw he got a little bit wide. Dropped the wheels off it. It just rained this morning a little bit, and that's all it takes.
And the other competitors taking extreme caution through that debris-littered area. That's how it sits in your four respective classes. Jeff Buckham now moves into the lead in P2. At Lime Rock and still under a full course caution, understandably. Lee Diffie here with Dorsey Schrader, Calvin Fish and Brian Till in pit lane. Watching live coverage of round three of the American Le Mans Series in a very damaged Intersport Lola on the back of the flatbed now. Be taken back to pit lane. Mike Durand is okay. We've seen him out of the car and walk away from what was quite a scary looking accident exiting the extremely fast West Bend section of this circuit. Good crowd in attendance here today. Of course, the 4th of July long weekend. And timing's everything, Dorsey, isn't it? We were just saying how it's been relatively incident-free. Pressure time now, though, in the Corvette camp. Ron Fellows will hand over to fellow co-champion in the American Le Mans Series GTS class. Johnny O is getting behind the wheel of the number three. The guys who have won two from two this year, the Mobil 1 12 Hours of Sebring and last weekend's Mid-Ohio. Good run so far for these guys. Cal, what do you have?
Down here with Clint Field. And Clint, disappointing end to your day. I know Mike was pushing hard. Any news from him? How's he feeling?
I think he's fine. He hasn't told us anything yet. But it's too bad. You know, we had the fastest car. And, you know, Mike just got in the car and Buckman was right on his tail, obviously pushing him pretty hard. So, you know, it's a mistake on Mike's part. But that's what you got.
There you hear it. Disappointment in his voice. And for Mike Durand, he hasn't driven a car since Sebring, so he's probably a little bit rusty. You start to get the pressure put on, Dorsey. That's always a tough one.
Yeah, it is indeed, and that's probably what it was. All it was that little bit of a mistake, you know, dropped the left side wheels off West Bend. It was wet just a little earlier, and it just pulled the car right out into the guardrail. It was a very scary little crash.
Working our way back toward green, but before we get to that, there was a special presentation here today on the front straight before the start of the race. You see Scott Atherton there, the CEO and president of the American Le Mans Series and Panos Motorsports. And all of the drivers surrounding him were there at the very first race, Sebring 1999, the American Le Mans Series. Today is race number 50, and there is the list.
All but one. I wasn't down there.
That's right.
Dorsey but I was Schrader at that first race.
That first event. 21 drivers, 19 of those are here. Tremendous stuff. Long careers for all of them in the American Le Mans Series. P2 class leading car, pitting. Jeff Buckham has done a great job to date, and of course the regular three drivers Chris McMurray and Brian Willman. They'll be excited about that. They've got about 30 guests of the team here this weekend. Excited, and they could be looking down the barrel of a Prototype 2 class victory here at Lime Rock today. Three portions so far today. When we come back, we will be going green on this 4th of July weekend here in New England. Speed Channel's coverage of the New England Grand Prix is brought to you by Audi. In technology, performance, and design, our goal remains constant. Never follow. Back here live at Lime Rock Park, the sun shines and weather is coming around back on our side. You're looking at round three of the American Le Mans Series. We've been at Sebring, mid-Ohio, and a busy time now during the summer. Two race meetings in two weekends. Next weekend is off, then the series moves to Infineon Raceway in California, followed by Portland right after that. We've mentioned several times today that it's the 50th American Le Mans Series race. Well, today, Johnny O'Connell, David Brabham, two of the fan favorites in this series and two champion drivers, they leapfrog Jan Magnussen for the most starts in the ALMS. And to Johnny and to David, that's a credit that they've only missed three in 5 years. Great stuff for those guys. Lights are off on the pace car. We are going back to racing here at Lime Rock Park. And that caution really helped to Andy Wallace in his search and chase for the Audi, sitting in second spot, race leader. James Weaver still doing a good job. Marco Werner chasing him. Look at this. Three abreast down through Big Ben. That's the Corvette, one of the Corvettes trying to get by the New Century Mortgage Racers Group Porsche. That's the four. Ollie Gavin on board. Currently sits second in class. Let's ride with the race-leading car, and you're looking at Marco Werner chasing him down.
Werner's car to get to the chicane at the top of the road. This is this next corner. This is where the accident happened. Mike Graham last time. The wastegate chirping.
Plus 1.8 over B2.
That time round. Problems for the Lamborghini, and Brian Till has more on that.
Well, Lee Petercock still sitting in the car. They got together with a Celine out there. They thought maybe it was just a toe link, but obviously more than that on the right rear. But David Brabham, great debut for the car at Mid-Ohio last weekend, and high hopes here, just a continuing development program for you guys, yeah?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, obviously it's a new program, new car. And really, this is just testing for us, so We need to keep it going as much as we can so we can learn as much about the car.
Well, they've learned a lot. Stirring battle for third in Mid-Ohio, ended up finishing fourth. Their troubles today, but by and large, certainly one of the sexiest cars out on the racetrack, Lee.
And they will continue to work on that. Speaking with Dick Barber earlier on, of course, it's Crone Barber Racing that own and run these cars. And Dick was quite pleased with that run at Mid-Ohio, but look at this, the battle for the lead. It's down to less than 1.8 seconds now as they flash across the line. It's down to less than a second. You ride with Marco Werner. Let's enjoy this view for a moment. Consecutively. If the Dyson Lola were to win today, that would break an incredible run. And you might say, whoa, look at this. Werner gets blocked heavily by one of the P2 class cars.
Almost got into the back of that P2 car. It was just right, slow, right in space. Now they're down, but this is a frightening corner. Very quick.
You might might say that the Dyson Lola beat the Audis last year at Infineon Raceway. You are correct, but remember that the Dyson cars were 675 cars last year. Of course, the terminology changed, class changed as well for those guys this year. A lot on the line for Dyson, a lot on the line for the ADT champion Audi team right here, right now.
This is when it's good, when you can see your adversary right in front of you, you can really get on. You see the two red lights on the side of that Audi, that's a designation for the people up in the around the hills here. That is the second place car. It's got two lights on right on the side there, and that shows the people if it's red lights, it's a P1 class car. If there's one on, it's in the lead. If there's two on, it's in second and third.
Here is the battle for the class lead in GT. We said that it's a great opportunity today for the Ferrari as it tries to get past the PK Sport Porsche. And it is pushing as hard as it possibly can. It's got flames and Porsche all over the back of it. But that's not the third place car in GT. So it's the 79 J3 Porsche. There it is. The yellow car is a lap car. The red car is not. It is second in GT. And it's struggling to get by the PK Porsche.
Really wants to get by that. It's a class lead if possible. Cars are very equally matched on their power off the corner.
Flying lizard Porsche. Back sixth in class with Darrell Wall behind the wheel. Now, it gets an opportunity, so too the Flying Lizard car, but remember that's not for position. And that was that dodgy side of the front end of the Ferrari. That's where it got nailed by the prototype car this morning. Racing team had to work
exactly what lap traffic will do to you here.
Charlie Porsche, thank you for fucking up.
Oop, we apologize for that. Of course, we are live, but we can't control what is said on team radio. It's been a wonderful day so far. The sun is certainly shining on the J3 team. And let's hear more from those guys here, Ryan.
Lee, you said it was a great opportunity for the Ferrari guys today, but for Justin Jackson and the J3 guys, a great opportunity for you, a best of six so far. Sebring, you've not been in the car yet today, but you're leading because of decisions that you made earlier on. How hard was it to decide to stay out on slicks?
It was really pretty easy. You know, if it's going to rain here at Lime Rock, it's going to rain for a long time. And, you know, the shower just came in at the last second, so we decided to stay out on the slicks. And, you know, the call worked out to our advantage. And, you know, now we've been out front. The Ferrari's right there with us on the lead lap. So just gonna have to run this thing to the end and run it hard.
And run it hard, they certainly plan to do, guys. They're very calm down here, very calculated. They've got a plan and they're gonna try to stick with it and see if they can end up on the top step of the podium.
Yeah, wonderful opportunity for the Atlanta-based team. Here's Marco Burner all over the back of Tim Sutton, though. Now he gets the run on the inside. Still chasing the overall leader, James Weaver, who is yet to hand over to co-driver Butch Leitzinger. That each and every Monday at 8 p.m. here on Speed, 9 p.m. Pacific. It's the show that takes you behind the scenes from the checkered to the green, the real world of NASCAR bush racing. It is NBS 24/7, of course, featuring Casey Kane, Tim Peterwer, and David Stremme. This chase continues. There's less than 2 seconds in it. We'll return on the other side of this. Perfect day to be sitting here on the hill at Lime Rock Park. We're celebrating not only July 4th weekend, but the 50th American Le Mans Series race. Let's take a look back at some magic moments. After the American Le Mans Series began in Sebring 1999, it then moved to its spiritual home, Road Atlanta. It was a wonderful race for the Italian team Raffanelli, one of the series' most popular teams. The then prototype organization wrote itself into the ALMS history books by winning the spring sprint event. Team boss Gabriele Raffanelli is one of the most colorful characters in the paddock, and naturally it was a robust Italian celebration. Mimmo Schiattarella would go on to drive many ALMS races, but none more special than this. Looking at the GT class battle, and it's becoming more and more intriguing as the Ferrari chases down the J3 Porsche, Tim Sugden, who has led almost the entire time. Now Anthony Lazzaro chasing those guys down. Cal, what do you have?
Well, unfortunately, it's bad news to the 37 car. Duncan Dayton brought the car in. It's a slow pit stop. They turned over to John Field. But Duncan, what is the problem with the car today?
The paddle shift isn't working. We got it locked in a third gear. Sometimes it gets elected, sometimes it can't. We've got a manual shifter in the car too, but it's something the paddle shift screwed that up, and so we're locked in third gear, so we're gonna have to take a look at the gearbox. But it's just a shame not to be able to take the fight to these guys.
Another frustrating day for this team. They won't have a chance to the lead in GT, I believe.
The Ferrari, it was in fact the 78 that the Ferrari got by. There is the lead GT car going into Big Ben right now. Two J3 horses running this weekend. And that's a shame for the Intersport 37. They had differential problems at Mid-Ohio. Now paddle shift problems here today. In the GTS class, there is the Corvette. Johnny O'Connell leads by more than 30-odd seconds over Oliver Gavin. It's a 1-2 in GTS for the Corvettes. Reminiscent of Mid-Ohio, Johnny Mollum in the Asemco Celine sits third. And there is one of our GTS cars. It is fast quarter Dodge Viper. Riding with the race-leading car, James Whipper. That is what 1.7 seconds looks like back to Marco Verna.
Werner trying hard to make up the deficit. Had a very close call with another car.
This is what it looked like.
Oh, whoa. A little bump there. Yeah, so he's like, will you look in the mirror, please? I'm here. Hello. It's a little frustration.
31, it is a white lightning car, has spun with Dave Murray at the wheel. Third place in GT. In fact, they've lost third place. They've been now relegated to fifth. Mark Leib has taken over third place for Alex Jobe Racing. And Timo Bernal, GT point leader, now sits fourth. Dave Murray relegated to fifth. The man who has won pole positions and races.
Now look at Weaver.
Lime Rock.
Weaver clear of all this traffic. Now the Audi gets by. Werner now one last car to get between him
and Weaver. He's on the passport Viper yet again. Here's what happened to Dave Murray.
That was just outside of the line a little bit. To the outside, got into the slippery stuff, around he goes.
Fortunately, everybody else avoided contact.
Now look out the back. There's no more Audi back there now. That's what traffic does. There's the Audi coming.
That's 3 seconds. 3 seconds he's put on Marco Verna with thanks to that traffic and some good hard driving from JJ, or rather from James Weaver. Former P2 class leading car on pit road. The 56, Brian Willman brings it in.
This should not be a scheduled stop, although I see he's got the steering wheel off and he's good now.
There's Chris McMurray standing by.
He overshot the pit. They've had to roll the car back into the pit. So the time lost there for sure.
Crew guy jumping in there as well. Problems, I think, down there in the cockpit. Brian Till.
They're doing the driver change down here. McMurray will take over from Willman. They had a hard time getting it into their spot because the Lamborghini's still in its spot being worked on. So Willman had to take it around that parked Lamborghini and then pull it back in. Chris McMurray will be getting in. It'll be a routine stop, fuel and tires. But that extra little bit of time that it took to get into the spot, everything here at Lime Rock, very, very costly. That could be as much as a half a lap on the race track.
Chris McMurray, oh, he lost his gun there.
It was a wheel nut. And he should have another wheel nut on his belt right there. He should have been able to get to that one quicker than going underneath the car. This is a disastrous pit stop for this car. Nothing working right now.
Brian Willman has just completed his first ever run at Lime Rock, and Chris McMurray about to begin his. These guys still sit second in P2. James QA for Miracle Motorsports leads the smaller of the prototype classes.
You're having trouble, something on the dash down there. You see one of the mechanics and they're trying to give a hand.
Now McMurray gets going. There is the class leading car in prototype 2. The young Georgian has just taken over from Ian James.
And will probably put the other car in the lap down.
Great to see the Murcielago, the Lamborghini, has been released from pit lane after a very, very elongated period in there. It's back out on the racetrack and it is busy. That is for sure. This is how it looks in P2 at the moment. It's the show where viewers have their rides transformed into the ultimate tuner car. They get the keys to your car and get to do whatever they like. It's Tuner Transformation, Tuesdays at 7 Eastern, 8 Pacific, here on Speed. Not sure they could do anything for your beach car, your little Suzuki.
You're out of help there.
It's beyond repair. Back at Lime Rock Park, welcome back to Speed's live and exclusive coverage of the New England Grand Prix. Race leader James Tuchel, who has an almost 3 second lead over this man here, Marco Werner, in the beautiful R8 Audi for 18 champion racing. He's had a troublesome time in traffic. Hey, Carmen Fish, how do you see the strategy playing out here with these P1 competitors?
Well, I just checked in with the Dyson Racing team, and they are within about 2 laps of being able to do it on one more stop, and they have about 15 laps worth of fuel in the tank, so they're in good shape there. They'll be able to do the rest of this race on just one more stop. The question will be when they stop. I do believe, just because of the pace that James has been running, he'll need to change all 4 tyres, which will certainly be costly in terms of how long he is on pit lane. I think the key for Marco Werner right now is he should be able to do a short fill in terms of being able to go longer than James Weaver, needing less fuel in the tank, Dorsey. But then the question for Marco Werner is, will he ask for new tyres and waste time in the pits?
You know, looking at both of these cars and the lap times they're running, they're both running awful hard. Weaver just ran a 49-second lap, so he's really on the boost right there. But tires around here, you know, the Michelin's on that Audi. I drove that car, but look at both these. The Michelin's can double stint. Now, whether he chooses to do that or not, that's the question.
Riding with Marco Werner. Through the chicane. What are your thoughts on not running the chicane? Is there any way these cars could have done that?
Well, you know, the reason they put it in here was back in the GTP days when John Morton actually blew over backwards and flew off the racetrack upside down. You know, we were at it on the Trans Am car, and you have the choice to lift. I mean, the driver doesn't have to go over that flat. You can lift and not fly the car, but they just deemed it unsafe. But I tell you what, they've had more wrecks in the chicane than they did before. Not as big, however.
From P1 to GTS, it is a Corvette Racing 1-2 with Johnny O'Connell leading the way, and we ride with Johnny right now. Been a wonderful start to the year for the reigning GTS champions, O'Connell and Ron Fellows. They have around about a 28-second margin over the sister car.
This Corvette team is so well prepared with Doug Feehan running this organization. We saw it at Le Mans with all the troubles they had, being able to rebuild 2 cars, not even rebuild 2 cars from scratch, and win that coming for a second. So very well prepared team. There goes our leader, I believe.
She's
one of the Dyson cars.
James Weaver. And a reminder too that for the Corvette guys, they get their Le Mans spec cars back for the next round at Infineon Raceway in a couple of weeks' time. And when they and we all are very excited about Dale Earnhardt Jr. joining that team to run in the American Le Mans Series.
That will be a big crowd.
Get close now.
Coming up on the Asenco Saline. Johnny Mullen, the car in front of Johnny O'Connell, sits third in class.
He's right on you.
And my guess is that is the radio communication to Johnny Mullen.
Yeah, well, he's telling about the Audi, he's right on you. That's a great thing to have a spotter to let you know that. The closing rate between these cars is quite phenomenal in some places.
Now Werner gets through on the inside of Mullen. In fact, it was communication to the three. One of the more spectacular moments on a negative side that we've seen today was the nasty-looking crash with Mike Durand, and he is with Calvin Fish right now.
Mike, that was a big moment out there, big, heavy impact with the guardrail. Tell us exactly what happened, mate.
Yeah, I mean, for 8 or 10 laps, Jeff Buckland and myself were having a great run, battling for first place. And I turned into West Bend, and bang, the car, the push rod holding the upright snapped. And next thing I know, the car's on the ground, just slid right into the tire barrier. I thought at first Jeff hit me. I wasn't too kind to him when he came around. But we saw the replay, you could just see it. We looked at the car and it snapped before it went in. That's it.
You have a scary moment indeed for Mike, and that's what this Lime Rock Park is all about. Very bumpy indeed. braking equipment. In fact, the Audi team, the champion Audi team, have gone through 5 radiators this weekend, just trying to keep the car together, Lee.
It's been a tough slog, hasn't it? That's for sure.
No, that's interesting. Mike didn't go off the racetrack on his own accord. He had a mechanical failure. Limerock, unfortunately, is not a time or forgiving place to have something work.
Well, it doesn't have the most drama for you to see.
No. Now, this is the no-name straight, and I can tell you one thing right now, it's not straight. Two people turned right in the middle of it.
The climb up the hill, TV doesn't do that justice either. It was very, very steep. Short, but incredibly steep as Johnny Mollen. Chasing class-leading GTS car. Corvette boys have done an outstanding job once again. Someone's went way wide on the entrance to the main straight, but that's pretty familiar here at Lime Rock Park.
You see that, and I saw that right away, that smoke. That's an indicator to my brain right away that, uh-oh, be careful here.
As we ride the GTS Asemco in GT, it's still Tim Sugden for J3 Racing from Anthony Lazzaro in the Ferrari, and Mark Lee for Alex Job Racing, the man who celebrated his 24th birthday yesterday, is starting to zero in on those guys. This is what it looks like though in GTS land, and we will have plenty more when we return. Second place in Prototype 2 class, Chris McMurray has spun in the left-hander. We welcome you back live to Lime Rock Park. And traffic has really been an issue. And let's have a look at a replay here. What happened exactly to Chris McMurray?
There goes the overall leader right in front of the second place P1 car, the Audi, a big spin. That could have been disastrous. Watch here. Oh, he got help. Audi hit him. No question about it. And then he says, what are you doing? I'd be asking him that question. What are you doing hitting me?
Well, I think, was there ever a move on there for Bernard?
Yeah, I'll tell you that now the right rear of this car might be damaging me. Pushed the fender up pretty good, and that's the second place. P1 car getting a little anxious. But you know what I was seeing right there was that the Audi was very close to J3. So must have been running a really good lap.
Remember, this is Marco Werner's first run here at Lime Rock Park. So to JJ Lado. I guess that one could go either way. You could say that Chris McMurray should have moved over for Lado, being the quicker car.
Now, did he damage this Audi on the nose sufficiently where he's going to have to stop left to the wall? Not coming in this lap.
Wide with Werner again. Lost more time.
Pretty stout right there on the nose. In front of the nose, it's put a little hole there. That could be a problem later down the road. Shorter in a speed booth. You got me, Rob?
Yeah, I've got you.
Having a handful of traffic today, huh?
Say that again?
Looks like pretty busy out there with traffic everywhere.
Yeah, it's very, very busy. People aren't really giving anyone any leeway, like here you can see. It's very, very difficult to get through traffic. People aren't making it easy. I feel bad that I hit the Lamborghini, but I was right down the inside of him. I had nowhere to go. You should have just given me the roof. But I do feel bad about that. So sorry to all the Chrome Barber guys.
How's the car feeling? You still got a lot of car underneath you?
Yeah, it's a very nice day in here. Fantastic weather, as you can see. I'm enjoying it.
We're enjoying the ride with you. Stay at it, mate. Good job.
Johnny Mollen for the Asemco Motorsports Celine sits third in class, third in GTS, and they've had a very good run so far this year for a brand new car.
Well, it's nice that he admits to hitting the Celine, or hitting the Lamborghini. Yeah. I mean.
4.4 seconds. We ganging up on the man we were just talking to.
Actually, I think it's Wallace right there that you're looking at, who's trying to make up.
Yeah, it's Andy.
Andy Wallace, who's in third place in P1. Trying to get by.
So pressure still on at the front. Riding with our race-leading car now, the downhill section.
This car's got to pit pretty soon, I would think. We'll be watching for it clearly. And this guy by the way.
Leitzinger is standing by in pit lane, and look who else is there. An interested onlooker, JJ Leto.
He's not supposed to be there. Get him out.
Watching very closely what the opposition is doing. Calvin.
Well, as you mentioned, guys, they're here. JJ, what's going on, buddy? You're in the wrong pit box.
I'm just checking the competition a little bit. It's going to get interesting anyway.
Tires with Marco Pizzafuel. Will he need tires or the mission is good the rest of the way?
He's fine with the Michelin tires. Tires are just so perfect this weekend, but we don't have any problems with them.
Hey, good luck. Certainly an interesting battle, boys.
Battle of the W's. Weaver versus Werner.
You heard JJ say it's going to get interesting here.
Yes.
And it will indeed.
That's the way it sits in the P1 class and overall. O'Connell and Gavin. Only Gavin now within 26 seconds of O'Connell and the Alex Job 23 on pit road. Cal.
Well, this is not a routine stop. Team of one behind the wheel. And Alex Job went to Mid-Ohio, didn't win there, and they're going to struggle to do it here today, Lee. There's a problem in the rear end. Somehow he came in real slow. I see metal shavings in the left rear corner of the wheel. And probably a drive issue with Timo Bernard. The team looks underneath. Jack stands are going under there. The team will go to work. They'll go many laps down.
First time for Bernard and Bergmeister here as well. Oh, wow, major, major piece of news. We have just heard from race control. The 38 ADT champion Audi is being penalized for hitting Chris McMurray. And this is where it happened several laps ago. Remember when McMurray was turned around by Werner, and we said it could have gone either way. There wasn't really a pass on there. Well, I guess the race officials agree. And they have penalized Marco Werner with a stop-go. Let's have a look at it.
No question about what, riding on board with the Audi. Watch this, boom! Just spins out the competition. It's not even a competition, that's P2 pass. But anyway, they're going to make him do a stop and go penalty, and that's quite costly on this racetrack.
The champion team will not be pleased with that. And look how close Werner is now to Weaver. Weaver dies for pit lane. Race leader is in. He has been on the track for an incredible amount of time.
Drinks bottle and lap threat. Drinks bottle and lap threat.
Reminding James okay. What's required. Calvin Fish is standing by.
Peter Weston guides him in and is push lighting. And these boys have won so many races together. This pitch stop should be like clockwork. He hands over the drinks bottle, the fresh one going in. He's going to sprint into the finish. I'm not sure he's going to have time to drink that water today. He's got a lot of pedaling to do, but the game is now on. Marco Werner has to do that stop and go penalty. They're going to put fresh tyres on it. Speaking of Peter Weston, he said we're going to go with a hard left rear because of the load that takes and soft all the rest of the way around. It's a brand new compound from Goodyear. It doesn't have a code name yet. Normally they run the 370 soft. He said, I guess this is about a 369, but it's much faster.
And Cal, here comes Werner. Here comes Werner for a stop-go. So he took over the lead momentarily. Now he comes in for his stop-go. Remember, further up pit road on the right-hand side is where Butch Leitzinger is being strapped in.
And the key is he will not be able to do any servicing. When they get a penalty like this, he can't stop and put fuel in. He has to stop and go and continue. No servicing is allowed.
Now he gets sent. So he remains in the lead, but that was costly time-wise. And Butch Leitzinger has stalled the Dyson Lola. Problems now, they're being held up. This is worse than a stop and go.
No, I don't even hear that engine running at all right now, so there's a big problem right there. These are very hard cars to get started once they're hot.
Oh, can you believe this? Just as they got a lucky break with the champion team.
It's back underway, guys. And actually on the first another stop on the course, and James Weaver had a similar situation when he went to refire. This time Brooks got it fired, stalled it momentarily, and then I love the lengthy delay. So this is going to be interesting to see how this plays out. Remember, Bernas Coleste stopped for fuel, and JJ said his tires are good, so it should be a short stop.
These cars carry like a small little 5-inch clutch, and when it's hot, it doesn't want to disengage, and it's really easy to stall. Now, the Audi has a launch control where the computer drives the car off of the pit by itself. I don't know if the NFG does that.
It is the might of Germany with the Florida-based ADT Champion Audi team up against the tiny team from Poughkeepsie, New York. Champion versus Dyson. Celebrating the 50th American Le Mans Series race here at Leimrock Park today. Time now to enjoy another magical moment. New Year's Eve 2000 was something special as the American Le Mans Series went down under to Australia. The Adelaide Grand Prix street circuit was again brought to life, but this time with the sound of sports cars and an incredible drive by Alan McNish. Before driving the one-off crocodile car, he injured his back lifting luggage at the hotel and considered not competing. But the diminutive Scott pushed through the pain, knowing that he did have backup with teammate Dindo Capello and Australian Brad Jones. It became obvious to the 100,000 strong crowd that he needed no help. McNish and Capello won the race of 1,000 years, the one and only Adelaide ALMS event, and McNish also clinched the 2000 ALMS title, his and Audi's first. Speed Channel's coverage of the New England Grand Prix is brought to you by Yokohama Tires. And troubles continue for Team Buckingham Racing. Right rear suspension problems.
It's probably from that hit with the Audi, which was on that same corner, I believe. He stopped on the no-name straightaway off the backside of the racetrack. Now he's got it fired, and we'll see if he can get back to pit lane on his own. See the damage.
It's going again.
Oh, yeah, he's going to wheel loose. He's got a broken suspension component on that.
The first time this happened this weekend. Oh, look at that. Anthony Mazzaro had to take a avoiding action of here, and one of the Dyson cars went through. He blew the chicane across the grass. Right. Severe damage for Chris McMurray.
Yeah.
Here's a replay. This may tell us more. It's already happened.
He's in trouble with that. He can get it back in pit lane. Maybe they can fix it for him.
And actually,
chances of winning.
We shouldn't blame Marco Werner for that because contact was on the
left side.
On the left side.
That is definitely a suspension failure or something.
And Chris McMurray has come to a stop now. We may be seeing our fourth full course caution.
He's at the entrance to Big Ben now. That's a very, very fast part of the racetrack where we saw Durant have an accident earlier, so I don't know that they'll deem that safe or not. And they are going to put out the full course yellow to get him out of there.
Fourth time while they head out to rescue Chris McMurray. Well, they picked up their second consecutive class pole and at one stage were leading, but the day has turned nasty for Team Buckingham Racing, sadly for those guys. Welcome back to Lime Rock, and if you've just joined us here on Speed, welcome to round three of the American Le Mans Series, the New England Grand Prix. Let's bring you up to date with what has happened thus far as we approach the two-hour mark in this two-hour, 45-minute race. Big, big accident for local driver Mike Durand in the Intersport Lola. He said it was something that failed that caused that. Fortunately, he first initially collided with the tyre barrier. Brian Willman brought in the Team Buckingham Racing prototype. They had a string of problems. It was just the beginning. Lost wheel nut. It went under the car. Crew guys finally found it. From here on in, the day went south for those guys. James Gouet and Ian James in the Miracle Motorsport Prototype 2 class car took over the lead of that category. We had a thrilling battle up front in the second hour between James Weaver and Marco Werner, but it seemed every time he got close, traffic came into play, but Werner nailed Chris McMurray going into the left-hander. McMurray didn't like it, and nor did the officials. He got a stop-go penalty for that. 16 came in for their stop. James Weaver drove the entire race. A very, very long stint for him up to this point. Butch Leitzinger took over. Marco Werner in the ADT champion out. He served his stop and go. But then Butch Leitzinger stalled the car. So the luck seesawed between Dyson and champion. Back to Dyson, and then it went back to champion as Leitzinger frustratingly stood motionless in pit lane. They finally got it fired up and went out. Since we were in commercial break, lots happened in pit lane. Update us, Cal.
Well, the champion Audi was in, Marco Werner, fuel only, and then he was underway with no fresh tyres. Both Corvettes win. New tyres and fresh drivers. Going to have Olivier Barreto behind the wheel of the 4 car, and Roland Montfellas behind the 3 with a big drama down here, the number 20, and Andy Wallace. He came in and said there was a problem with the paddle shift, and now he's having a similar problem to Butch Leitzinger just getting this AR engine fired back up. Team are in radio communication with him, trying to work him through it. There's a lot of systems on these cars, but initially it was the gearbox. They got that fixed. Now he's underway, and he's saying there's some kind of problem. It seems like
the wrong map's still in. There's throttle jacker map still in.
Seems like he's got full throttle when he fires the engine. That's what it sounded like. There's so many electronic gizmos on these machines now. It only takes one to hiccup, and it really affects the whole lot. So they'll try and get it dialed in, but I think he just lost the lap, boys.
He was in second place.
And he did indeed just lose a lap. Calvin's pace car has just gone by. Brian, you got something on GT Force?
Well, Dorsey, your two GT leaders were in. Tim Seguin brought the 79 car in. Justin Jackson took over. And the yellow could not have been timed more perfectly for those guys. Literally, they were within 3 to 4 minutes of having to stop in order for Justin Jackson to have gotten his 45 minutes in the car. So the yellow perfectly timed for them. Lazaro also brought the 35 Ferrari in. And Ralph Kelleners has taken that back over. It was good that they could do it under the yellow also, because they were able to gain some ground on the 79 car, but it will now be a 45-minute shootout to the checkered flag.
Guess who leads GT as we see Andy Wallace exit pit lane. The Ferrari is there. Ralph Kelleners, after taking over from Anthony Lazaro, in front in GT. The birthday boy from yesterday, Mark Lieb, after his teammate Romar Dumas put it on pole for the first time in his career, they're up to second. And Darren Law for Flying Lizard Motorsport, he is in third after taking over from Johannes van Overbeck. The view from the Porsche Mail to Web Aerial Cam. We need to squeeze in a quick break here from Lime Rock as we bring you up to date with our four respective classes. Who is sitting in the top spots? And there certainly has been plenty of position changes today. Fellows at Beretta have just taken over. So too has Borchella. And in GT, it should be a thrilling finish all the way to the checker. Final 45 minutes. With Washington DC's RFK Stadium filling the backdrop, the American Le Mans Series again created an historic sports car street race. The ALMS raced through the nation's capital for the first time, and the race for victory was as tough as any presidential campaign. Tom Christensen in the Audi and fellow Dane Jan Magnussen in the Panos set the DC streets on fire with super tight racing and numerous passes for the lead. The Panos LMP, decked out in the stars and stripes, was the car for this unique event. Magnussen and longtime co-driver David Brabham eventually did enough to hold off Christensen and take one of the few hard-fought overall race wins for the Panos prototype. Brabham, Magnussen and Panos certainly wrote the headlines in DC. Great moment in American Le Mans Series history, that's for sure. Tuesdays at 7:30 Eastern, reminding you that Sports Car Revolution, one of the new shows on the Speed Network. The place to be happens 7:30 Eastern, 8:30 Pacific. You can improve your technique from the track to the street. Sports Car Revolution. You can stay up to date with everything you need to know about the American Le Mans Series and sports car in general. SpeedTV.com as well as AmericanLeMans.com. Two great websites keeping you up to date with the ALMS. Still under caution, it's our fourth for the day as they snake their way around towards the uphill. Well, we saw before we went to commercial break dramas for the 20 of Andy Wallace. Give us the update, Calvin.
Randall Kelsey is the team manager for the 20 car. Talk us through the sequence of events there with Andy Wallace.
Under yellow, Andy got stuck in second gear. He couldn't upchange or downchange, so we brought him in. We needed to do a fuel stop anyway. Brought him in, did our fuel stop. Then we had to pull the rear deck lid off. put a pin in the manual lever to allow him to change manually. Then we had to change it, put a new map in the ECU to allow him to change manually. So he's doing all right now, but just no paddle shift.
Okay, there you see a lot of work. Green, boys.
Back to green, and Werner, just look at that. That paints the picture so well. Werner has just bolted, and there is a gaggle of GT cars all scrapping amongst each other while Butch Leitzer has got to try and fight his way through there to catch up to this man, Marco Werner.
And this can give Werner a complete half a lap lead over Leitzer because there's nothing in the world you can do with that traffic when it's in front of you too wide like that.
Look at this. That last portion has brought the GTS boys together. It is a scrap between Ron Fellows and Olivier Beretta. Ollie Gavin did a marvellous job in that last stint. He was really starting to eat into Johnny O's lead. The pit stop brought them together. GT leaders, it's Kelleher's, Dumas, and Darren Law.
Kelleher's with the red Ferrari out front for the first time. That's great to see that car coming along in its development.
Last time round, when we went to break, we were switching the timing scoring. And you may have noticed that there was a mistake as far as what we said to what we showed in the graphic, but that is correct as now. Great scrap in the GT, yes, and GT classes. 1, 2, and 3 in GTS. It's Fellows who holds the higher ground at the moment. Let's talk GT. As one of the new Century Mortgage Races Group cars comes through, here is the GT leading car, Ralph Kelleher, Joey as he's known.
Two Corvettes are running 4th, 5th overall, so having a really good day with that GTS battle. Beautiful Ferrari and GT. Kelleher's, he'll be on a mission.
Well, for Giuseppe Ricci and for Mickey Sims and everyone who's worked so hard on this project, this would be something very special, Brian, if they could hang on and grab this win.
Special indeed, Lee. Now, Anthony, I know that the yellow was good for your J3 neighbors next door, but you guys still able to take the lead on that pit stop. You got a pony that's going to take you to the checkered flag. It looks like you guys got the pace today.
You know what? The team gave us a good strategy and put us there. Pirelli's given us a tire to keep us there. And I got Ralph Kelleher, my teammate, the best driver in the field right now. And I tell you what, the guy's a bulldog, so there's any stopping him.
Well, they have not had good luck so far this season. It looks like it could have turned around right here for him. We're going to have to wait another 35 minutes or so to find out. Please.
Well, no doubt we're going back now because Kelleher is all over the back of Justin Jackson. He is right there with the J3 car. That car, in fact, sits 3rd in class. Darren Law has now got the flying lizard car up to 2nd, but Kelleher is flying, and Justin Jackson is in the hot seat.
But this on the front straightaway is the place we should be. Look at the line. Everybody's getting defensive. He doesn't want to be past that easily. The flags you see flying all over are Catholic flags. You see right back in the corner over there. Letting people know that the battle is on.
Exercising a little bit of patience there, just taking it easy. Was caught in the middle of an incident earlier on. It's a hot old day, hot hard work here at Lime Rock Park. You're watching the ADT champion Audi, Marco Werner, the reigning American Le Mans Series champion. He won the P900 category, which is now known as P1, with Frank Mueller last year, on a team with JJ Leto, and he has a 16-second lead over Butch Leitzinger for Dyson Racing in 2nd, Andy Wallace in 3rd, a little further back. 4th overall is Ron Fellows, who has less than half a second over teammate Olivier Beretta. And then in 6th overall, 3rd in GTS class, Terry Borchella in the Saline. But watch the way that Werner weaves his way through traffic and already being involved in one key incident that cost him a stop and go. He's being particularly careful now.
And that 16-second lead that he has really was all right there to start when Leitzinger in 2nd place got held up by all the GT cars that were having a battle of their own.
GTS, it's hot at the moment. Look at this, the 4 on the inside. Olivier Beretta has got Ron Fellows. Now Fellows tries to come back. The team car's scrapping and going hard at it. And due to the way
good
the
job,
portions
good
fell
job
at Mid-Ohio, this battle was diluted They went some 50-odd seconds down the four car and never really could get up there and mix it with the sister car. And Ronnie and Johnny got their second consecutive victory. But for the reigning champions, they've got to do it a little tougher today because Gavin and Beretta are now in the lead.
Great pass, Gavin. Breaking into turn one. Look right here, coming down the downhill, long straightaway. He's going to come down, set up this pass to the inside, and he's going to hit this curb. Watch the recoil. Jump up in the air right there. You see the left rear tire really jumping up and down. Ronnie won't like that. Fellows doesn't like being passed. He'll try to get it back.
What you have to understand about this team while you watch the view from Ron Fellows' car, there is a directive in this team that they must not contact each other. Doug Feehan has laid down the law and said that that is unacceptable. They're allowed to race, but they are not allowed to contact. But that was a good, clean pass from Beretta.
His teammate is here, Ollie Gavin. Ollie, you have been in catch-up mode all day. Explain how you got behind the three car.
Yeah, it's a bit unfortunate, but it just so happened that when the safety car came out for this, the time before this last one, it caught us out. It was in between me and the three car, so we ended up going a lap down. So, yeah, like you say, we've been pushing really, really hard, and Olivier just got past Ron, just coming to turn one here. That's fantastic. I just want to say hi to my mum. She's getting better. Getting really better.
We mentioned earlier, his mother came down with an ailment while she was here to see him race for the first time in 3 or 4 years. She was in hospital, now she's in the friend's house and feeling much better. And a win would certainly make everything feel better, I think.
The number four, Cal. It was the sixth at Sebring. It was a second at Mid-Ohio. Gavin and Beretta, they go all the way here today and stand on the top step. It's been a while since Ollie Gavin.
Nice job. More pairs of three cars behind you. Now it's time to get a little distance from the three car. You're doing a good job. Drink water.
Communication there to the four car of Olivier Beretta. You ride now with Fellows.
Here through the chicane they go, you have to say drink water, you gotta remind your driver.
Okay, Ronnie, this is like old-time Trans Am racing, okay? Save those rear tires, keep them in sight, and when it's time to go, we'll let her rip.
Old-time Trans Am racing, I can tell you about, because that was my boy right there that I had to race against. Ron Fellows and I had some great, great classic battles, him and his Chevrolet, me and my Ford around this place. And that's Danny Biggs, his old crew chief on the radio, back with him again. After so many years with
that lap, you were 3/10 quicker. Nice job. Keep drinking your water. Bunch of traffic coming up here.
It's important to them to tell the driver to drink the water. You don't have time to think about it on a 50-second lap around here, and that's what these guys are doing. 52 seconds.
Speaking of old-time Trans Am racing, the last time Ron Fellows was here was 1996 when he was driving a Camaro in Trans Am. He was leading the race and had driveline failure, so Fellows has unfinished business here at Lime Rock Park. Riding now with Jacinto Salim with Terry Borchella. He is trying to get his lap back.
Told Terry right at the beginning after this restart, get that lap back.
Most exciting times in ALMS history was when Ferrari arrived to take on Corvette that had the boys in yellow somewhat concerned. Petit Le Mans 2002 was a memorable clash between the GTS heavyweights. Throughout the day and night, the lead changed hands multiple times, but the major turning point was when the class-leading Ferrari was pressured into a late-race incident and Corvette snatched the victory. Ron Fellows, Johnny O'Connell and Oliver Gavin won the first of many amazing battles between two of the best cars in the field. And the ProDrive Ferrari team was forced to wait until Road America last year for its first victory. Jan Magnussen hounded Johnny O'Connell and pulled off a pass that will be remembered by Ferrari fans for a long time. The Corvette had no answer for the slippery 550 Maranello on the high-speed Road America circuit, and Magnussen and teammate David Brabham created some ALMS GTS history of their own. to remind you that in just 2 weeks' time, we head out west to the Infineon Raceway for the Infineon Grand Prix of Sonoma, the next race, round four in the American Le Mans Series, and you can catch that on CBS from 3 p.m. Eastern. And of course, the most watched driver will be Dale Earnhardt Jr. Mid-May, he went to Gingerman Raceway in Michigan and enjoyed some time with the Corvette team. Of course, he's raced with them before at the Daytona 24 Hour. Joined old friends Boris Said and Ron Fellows and the team from Pratt & Miller and went through some information. And by all accounts, he did very, very well, Dorsey.
Yes, he did do very well, and that's going to be great for the fans out there. Week after that, we'll be in Portland. Right there on speed.
So it's a busy couple of weeks out on the West Coast for the American Le Mans Series. Let's update you with some more information on GTS and Calvin Fish.
Well, as Ollie Gavin mentioned, Lee, when you've got four races within a race, sometimes when you get a caution, that can really throw the cat amongst the pigeons. Try to recreate this here on the dry race board. Essentially what we had the three car leading the four car by about a few seconds here, maybe 2 seconds. The leader of the race had got in between these two cars. We went to caution, and what happens is the pace car will pick up the leader and come out here. This then allows the number three car to go all the way around to the back of the field and pick right up behind the number four car, picking up about 50 seconds. Okay, so that was what Ollie Gavin and Olivier Beretta were dealing with. They just got caught out with the leader being right in between those two Corvettes and effectively gave the three car a 50-second lead.
Very good work, Poisson. Who said you were a high school dropout?
Hey, and I tell you what, that is something that in these endurance racing, if you're not in the top class, the P1 class overall, those things happen to you. There's nothing you can do about it.
Less than half an hour to run here at Lime Rock Park. And while it's pretty thrilling stuff in GTS, it so too is in GT. Darren Law has bridged the gap to these guys, to the Ricci Ferrari, to now he's narrowed it down to 50 seconds. So last week's winner, Darren Law, Racing is really starting to zero in on the Ferrari. Incidentally, here's a point, statistical point, the last non-Porsche to win.
If we get a yellow, there's no way he can be ahead of you, Ralph. He will always be behind you. He may just be closer, but there's no way he can be ahead of you. Keep doing what you're doing. We're doing good.
BMW, Petit Le Mans 2001. Porsche has dominated this class for a long, long time. This could be an amazing day for Ricci Ferrari. Here's the Alex Joe Porsche, the 24 of Mark Lee, and Romain Dumas behind the wheel. He's in third place, trying to get a lap back. Really put the pressure on Kelleners, but Kelleners wasn't having anything to do with it.
But that battle's not over. Like you say, it's not for position, but he wants that lap back because if he catches caution, there'll be another Porsche in this thing that could win overall, or win that class. Kellner's not having any of it, though. Looking at Darren Law, who is in second, he's 50 seconds back, is about a half a second behind the Junior. There's Darren Law right there coming down the hill. He's running a half a second lap more than the Ferrari, so it's still a long way to go, though, to make up 50 seconds.
While we look at one of the flying lizard cars, let's update you on some team information. The other car, Lonnie Pechnik and Seth Simon, they are driving a huge GT3 RSR this weekend. The team works incredibly hard to get it up to date. Brian, what do you have for us?
Johannes Van Overbeck, great win from Mid-Ohio, but Lee Dippy putting the pressure on you in the booth, telling us the last time a Porsche has not won a GT race was back in 2001. Did Darren catch up with the Ferrari? Is it going to take a yellow to get there?
If anybody can do it, Darren can, but I think without a yellow, it's going to be really tough. The Ricci guys are pretty strong today.
Traffic plays such a big part around this racetrack. Even getting caught in traffic right now, will that bring him back to you? I mean, you guys are setting a torrid pace.
Anything can happen here in Lime Rock. There's people going off left and right, a lot of yellow so far. So I don't wish it on them, but on the other hand, I'd like to be nice to win again.
Yeah, but on the other hand, Lee.
Yeah, exactly. And with BMW being the last non-Porsche to win in GT, the coincidence there is that Darren Law and Johannes Van Overbeck used to race together in a BMW.
Riding on board now with Michael Werner. That's the P1 lead.
There he is. Ralph Kellner's leading GT. We just rode momentarily with Marco Werner. Werner's lead has been reduced, and substantially. It's now down to 11 seconds. But this guy here, looking good at the moment. Ferrari Racer, 360 Modena, bending on. Romain Dumas, who tries to get his lead in his lap back. 31 is the Peterson White Lightning car. The
flying because the Carlos Smart I was telling you about, they flew it out from Germany in between last weekend's race in Ohio, and now the team worked incredibly hard to get along now and finally got the car put together here on Friday night, and Seth Diamond, Ronnie Petching, took it out on Saturday morning. It's been an incredible week for the Flying Lizard organization.
That was a complete build-up, I mean, from total scratch. All they had was a car with a roll cage in it, so they had to move it up. I was getting close to the outside, they didn't want to do that. That's a lot of work for anybody to do. Just
that is Seth Diamond. See, principal behind the car for that. With our race leader, Marco Werner, is in the lead. Can he hang on? Each and every Tuesday here on Speed at 8 Eastern, 9 Pacific. Tequila Tuesday with Greg White. Of course, it's a very big week in motorcycling here in the United States this week with the round of the World Superbikes coming up on Laguna Seca next weekend.
Look at this. This is Marco Werner, and right in front of him is one of the Dyson cars. Now, is he going to hold him up? I believe it's the 20 of Andy Wallace. Now, he can make an outcome of this. He can keep this... If he can keep Marco behind him long enough, break that momentum.
And right now, Rob Dyson and the guys are saying to Butch Leitzinger, go, 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 as hard as you can, because your teammate's up ahead. And he may be able to just hold Werner off a little bit for you. We'll update you on that margin when we come back. These guys on the hill are in for a thrilling finish. The best David and Goliath battle in ALMS history was Dyson versus Champion at Infineon 2003. Weaver and Leitzinger in the smaller 675 Dyson Lola were determined to beat the mighty Champion Audi R8, and they did. James Weaver passed F1 star Johnny Herbert late in the race, and the tiny team from upstate New York did what they weren't supposed to do. They defeated one of the best sports cars of all time, and along the way became the first 675 prototype to win an ALMS race overall. Understandably, the team, Butch Leitzinger and James Weaver, were thrilled. And how appropriate that that was our fifth magic moment, because we're viewing it again. It's Dyson versus Champion. The lead car is in fact the last car in that group right there. Andy Wallace is on the right of your screen. He is not on the same lap as race leader Marco Werner. And Werner is getting incredibly frustrated not being able to get by Andy Wallace, because it's allowing Butch Leitzinger, the other Dyson car, to catch up. When we left you, the gap was 11 and a half seconds. It went down as low as 6.9. It's back up to around about 9 seconds. But watch this. We've got a series of shots for you from on board with Marco Werner. And there he is. Our second place car has just gone under the bridge. Leitzinger is zeroing in on Marco Werner. But Werner is very, very hot at the moment. He was angry with Andy Wallace as they were coming through traffic. Take a look at this.
Right on board here, you're going to see he's going to start gesturing. He's really mad. He's saying, come on, let me by. You're not on the same lap. And he thinks he's being held up by Andy because of Leitzinger coming. Now, one thing you do know is that Leitzinger has no radio communication. They can't tell him, except for pit boards, what's going on here. Line there to try to get some help.
Hey, this traffic has played into his hands too. 7.8 seconds. Leitzinger's coming, and Werner's being blocked again by the 19. Looks like the van was prototype. Now he gets by there. Werner has had a dreadful day in traffic today.
And all this frustration in Lamarck usually leads to one thing, and it's a mistake by the driver. Any little mistake here, you could... Oh, and he just got wide there almost too.
Now here's the second place car. This is Butch Leitzinger.
Once he can see that Audi up there, all bets are off.
If anyone knows what it's like to come from behind to Lyman Park, it is Butch Leitzinger, as well as doing very well in other sports car races here. The Van der Stoer car's crashed.
Well, that's been crashing all day. It just finally hit something. But that's going to bring out a full course caution because it's underneath the tire wall.
Dyson just slammed me into the wall.
Oh,
he said the Dyson car slammed me in the wall. That was Leitzinger.
You are okay? Are you okay?
Now you can see the left front suspension. There's a full course caution. Now things are going to get interesting.
Eric Van der Stoer in the car, but we believe okay.
His words were that he was hit by one of the Dyson cars. Well, Andy Wallace had already cleared him, so that left Butch Leitzinger, who was on a charge. The point I was making was that Leitzinger has come from behind him three times in Busch North Series racing here at Lime Rock Park. Loves this circuit, knows how to win here. And Eric van der Stoer, not all that pleased. And that car has been in the middle of quite a few incidents here today.
Well, once again, that's up on top of the hill in West Bend, so it's another one of those high-speed areas.
Fifth full course caution of the day here at Lime Rock. Cal, what do you have?
Brad Kettler is on the radio with Marco Werner. Marco doesn't say much on a good day. Is he getting frustrated out there on the radio?
He's gotten a little frustrated today. It's a very, very vigorous track. The rhythm of it's really high. And he got a little worked up with Andy, caught Andy, and then Andy suddenly was digging in, really pulling out, making him work for it. So it's everything's fair and straight up at the moment. But we had 5 seconds when the yellow came out, and we're hoping to hold on to it.
Okay, well, it's a lot of fun. There's a smile on their face. We'll see if that changes, boys. We've got a little bit of racing left today.
And team owner, team principal, Dave Mirage in the background there. He looked quite excited as well. Let's take a look at what happened to the 19 van der Stoer prototype. This is the reason for the full course caution on board with Butch Leitzinger. Whoa, there was contact there. The van der Stoer car on the outside. Not sure whether he actually saw the Dyson car on the inside. One of those tough breaks. Not much runoff here at Lime Rock. When there's an incident, it's usually a big one. We'll make the most of this caution and squeeze in a quick break. Stay with us. Barrett Jackson Car Search, each and every Wednesday at 7:30 Eastern, 8:30 Pacific, right here on Speed, the show that has three teams of experts competing to find that undiscovered gem in the collectible car world, the Barrett Jackson Car Search, every Wednesday here on Speed. Still under caution, let's get an update from the pits.
Well, in P1, I think the advantage heads up may go to the Dyson car. Remember, they put fresh tyres on. Marco Werner did not. But Marco Werner's been frustrated with the traffic. That will go away when they go back to green. But he'll probably be in traffic within about 6 laps. As James Weaver put it, when you're the leader and you come into traffic, that's like being a minesweeper. In P2, the number 10 car is a healthy lead. Just checked in with Ian James. He said we've had a very smooth run. We haven't been the fastest car, but we've kept the nose out of trouble. And in GTS, well, it's a battle between the two Corvette boys. They have a lap lead over the Celine. They're in great shape. I spoke to Gary Pratt. He said the main thing is traffic. If one of our boys gets held up in the downhill, the other boy will get a run, and then it's anyone that goes for it. Let's go down to Brian Till for the GT story.
Calvin and GT, it's checked in with the guys in the competency, Yoni Ferrari down there. They say they're good. They're happy with their Pirelli tires. They've developed the Pirelli tire a lot this year. It's got a better shoulder on it. It lasts a lot longer, and it stays very consistent. They feel like their Michelin competitors go away a little bit, and that is indeed what the 45 car is on. They're very fast for a couple of laps, but then that Michelin tire falls off, at least they say, down in Trici Competizione. It'll be interesting to see now if the Ferrari can beat that winning streak that Porsche has owned for so long in GT.
Ralph Kellner's Anthony Lazzaro Ferrari never won in GT in American Le Mans Series competition. We'll see if they can do it. After consecutive weekends of racing in the American Le Mans Series, the teams and drivers get a much-earned week off next weekend, but in 2 weekends' time, the Infineon Grand Prix of Sonoma and Infineon Raceway. Then the following weekend, here on Speed, the Portland Grand Prix, a welcome return to the Portland track. That should be fabulous up there. So a week off next week and then two very busy weekends. This is how it sits in our four respective classes at the moment as we are still under caution nearing the end of this race. It's Werner, Leitzinger, Wallace and Field, P2, Ian James and James Gouet set for victory here over Ryan Eversley and Andy Lally. And then it's been a troublesome day for Team Bucknam Racing. In GTS, it's the two Corvettes, one and two, with Beretta holding the higher ground in the four, and Borchella trying desperately to get his lap back. And in GT, it is looking great for the Ferrari to take victory over Flying Lizard and Alex Joe. We'll return in a moment. Welcome back to Lime Rock Park as we get prepared to go racing green all the way to the finish. There's some 7, maybe 6.5 minutes remaining. There you have it, 6:08 remaining. and we have a thrilling battle on our hands. As far as GT is concerned, it's looking pretty comfortable for the Ferrari, and in P2, it's looking very comfortable for the Miracle Motorsports team. We are going to focus our coverage on the battle for P1 and GTS, particularly P1, where Marco Werner sits lead car. See, right on the top right-hand side of your screen, there are two Flying Lizard Porsches in between he and Butch Leitzinger. There has been communication between the Dyson team and the Flying Lizard team, asking them, can they be considerate of their goal and what they hope to achieve? And I think that those two Porsches may cooperate and give Butch Leitzinger a quick run
to take the battle.
There you hear. 5 minutes to go, and they told here that the Flying Lizard guys will move out of the way and let him run.
This is it. We're going to green. Pace car off. Let's go. Lime Rock, this is the race to the finish, and Speed's live coverage will stay here to the checkered flag. And look at this. Lightning is already by one. He's got 1 point to get by. That is Darren Law, but Werner got a terrific jump on him.
Werner got a great jump on the downhill, something you can use. He's at downhill with the acceleration. Now, nobody between the lead two. Let's see who's got the speed.
It's a one-on-one fair fight now with a clear track ahead for the time being. Werner in the ADT Champion R8. Remember, their 16-race winning streak is on the line here. The Dyson AER could snatch victory if Butch Leitzinger can take the fight to Marco Werner.
In the GTS class, you have the two Corvettes right there. The four leads to three. You got about five laps max right now to get it done, boys.
Does Ron Fellows have anything for Olivier Beretta? We will find out. Calvin.
Johnny O'Connell, you got your man Ron Fellows behind the wheel. What does Doug Feehan tell the drivers when you can just sort of battle going head-to-head?
Well, this lead is definitely no hit anyone, but, you know, it's been a really good fight all day long. Ronnie's right with him right now. You know, Olivier being very defensive, but if there's a guy that can get by, it's Ron Fellows. You know, he loves his place. He's really strong, and, man, these Compuware Corvettes right now, they're racing so hard that you wonder whether they're both going to be rolled up on the trailer.
Okay, well, the four car took the 24 hours of Le Mans victory, but these guys, right now, a little bit to go, are undefeated in ALMS League.
It's awful hard to get by somebody who doesn't want to be got by, especially if you're under orders not to help him a little bit, which his teammates have been told, don't touch the other car.
Talking about the overall standings, Werner versus Leitzinger. Werner had an outstanding opening lap at a sub-50-second one. 49.8 versus Leitzinger's 51 second or so. Now they've both gone into the 49. So Leitzinger, he's 4 seconds behind.
2 minutes left, three. Coming up onto traffic here, 2 9-11s in a row.
That could be as a result, as we heard earlier on the pit report, of the Michelin tires coming up to temperature quicker than the Goodyear tires. That could have left Butch with a slow car for the outlap.
The Alex Jones Porsches here.
Oh!
Fellows needs to negotiate.
These two Corvette guys giving it their all. That was really near a spin back there coming off that turn two.
It's allowing Olivier Beretta to skip away. Clock is ticking. Only 2:40 remaining here at Lime Rock. There is your race leader as we continue to ride with Fellows. Werner creeps up another lap. What will be the margin? There's Leitzinger at the bottom of your screen. 4.1 seconds, almost identical lap times.
That's a tenth of a second. These two lead cars. Unfortunately, the lead that time was Leitzinger.
Left
right
screen.
On the edge of two, so he'll probably get the white flag this time by.
Communication with the Corvette camp, and Ron Fellows is seeing
one,
the sister
one
car.
AMG five, a couple seconds one, back. I'll keep you posted.
With a healthy margin at the moment. Closing laps. Possibly see the white flag, the last lap flag this time by for the ADT champion Audi.
There's no way Butch can
make
up this deficit in one lap
and get
a white flag. No, I don't think they got it.
No white flag this time by.
Gives him one more lap of trying to catch up, but I don't think so. I think it's too little too late. There's the interval. There's Butch Leitzinger.
Keep an eye on that Celine because we don't want him to do anything stupid, okay?
Both these drivers know that if they make a mistake, it's over with. We're hearing that Corvette radio. They're running, of course, 1-2 in their class.
Showing you both in the key battles. And let's not forget the Ferrari as well. For Ferrisi Competizione, a huge moment for those guys. Their first GT victory.
MG's right
ALMS
there now.
Competition on the line. And it's within reach, just a couple of laps away.
Butch has made up some ground that lap, no question about it.
closes the gap.
Four-vet battle seems to have gone Olivier Barreto is on McGavin's way. Meanwhile, up front, Werner.
Traffic, Werner.
Weaving through the traffic. Sees the white flag this time by. He is within 1.5 miles from victory. And it is seesawed. Champion's way. Dyson's way. At the moment, the German holds the upper hand for the Florida-based team as he deals with more traffic.
That one held him up right there. He couldn't get by that car. Now he's made that pass. And now, Butch Leitzinger is stuck.
Coming by the P2 class leading car with James Gouet at the wheel. Make some ground now, but with half a lap left to run, it will be Marco Werner's race so long as nothing untoward happens. But Butch is not giving up, that's for sure.
It's a desperation move, he has no choice, he's got to go with what he's got right now. It's not going to happen.
What a valiant effort. And for Marco Werner, JJ Lado, they had not seen this track before in their driving careers, but it doesn't matter, they're victorious in the New England Grand Prix. He was frustrated before, but now Werner, JJ Lado, and the ADT champion boys can celebrate. Back-to-back victories for the Audi R8.
And they had to fight hard for this one. This is not an easy win.
What a completely different race to last weekend at Mid-Ohio. They really had to work hard for it. In GTS, it will be the first victory of the year as far as ALMS competition.
Good job, Mike.
Oliver Gavin and Olivier Barreto victorious in the GTS Corvette.
Hey, way to go, way to go, man. Good.
And our GT class winning car, the first time ever. Lazzaro and Kellners have not stood on the top spot in ALMS, nor has the Risi Ferrari. And it breaks that incredible winning streak of Porsche. You have to look back to 2001. The Petit Le Mans road at ladder with BMW.
Nice job, Ralph. Nice job. Take a long way home, Ralph. Take a long way home.
It's the Porsche dominance.
Okay, congratulations.
That's a great thing for that team. They've worked so hard.
Fine. And Lazzaro says, finally. And we also must not forget the Miracle Motorsports team of James Gouet and Ian James. They win the P2 class. When we come back, we'll hear from our class winners.
Speed Channel's coverage of the New England Grand Prix is brought to you by Audi. In technology, performance and design, our goal remains constant. Never follow.
Back live here at Lime Rock Park in northwestern Connecticut. What a finish. What a day for the American Le Mans Series 50th race. It will be one to remember. Lado Werner, successful again twice in the space of 8 days. And a thrilling finish in the end. It was 1.4 seconds, Calvin. Tight stuff.
It was a fantastic battle. JJ Lado and Marco Werner coming out on top eventually. And Marco, I'm not sure if you've driven on this type of bullring racetrack before. Traffic was really getting you frustrated there for a while.
Yeah, that was a big problem. But only the first thing was to the tires in the yellow laps. It was a little bit difficult. But I think was everything fine. I can start very nice after the green flag, and that was important. But the key for the race, I think, was in the beginning from JJ. He take a little bit risk, but that was the key for the race.
Well, a superb team performance. Excellent job by the champion team. They're still on their winning streak, Lee.
Yeah, nice work. We thought that that 16 race winning streak for Audi was in jeopardy, but not so. In GTS, that was the other tight scrap, wasn't it? And Gavin and Barreto, they pick up their first ALMS victory of the year over points leaders Fellows and O'Connell, and that's 3 third places for the Asemco Saline. Brian?
Down with the Corvette driving duo, O-squared, Olivier Barreto and Oliver Gavin, a tremendous job. The best battle on the racetrack, probably in the latter part of the race. Olivier bringing in Oliver. What a tremendous job. You guys didn't have the luck you wanted at Sebring, but you tasted the champagne in Le Mans. You're back in the championship now, guys.
Yes, you're right. I mean, Oli did a fantastic job because when we pit on the second yellow, we have lost one lap. So the only solution was to push, and he did a great job on the traffic. He was fast, and when I take the car, I try to do the same. And, well, we won. I just want to thank GM, the Corvette, the whole crew, Pratt Miller, and also the CompuWare guys, because thank you for your help.
A lot of things going on. I know you've got somebody to say hey to.
I won the race for my mom. Get well soon, mom. Love you.
Yeah, you're
tremendous
right.
Job on these guys. The championship in GTS, I think it's wide open, Lee.
Yeah, boy, did they have to work hard to get back. They really scratched their way back. We congratulate Ian James and James Gouet. John Macaluso didn't get in the car, but that adds to their win at Sebring, and they'll be delighted with that. And considering where Ryan Eversley and Andy Lally were in the swamp, they're a good second place. Calvin?
Well, it's the James brothers, Ian James. James, go ahead. Yeah. Ian, Sebring, it probably seems a long time ago, but good to be back in victory circle, I'm sure.
Yeah, no, it's great. This Miracle Motorsport car, the Yokohama tyres, me and James, I think we make a great combination today. Big thank you to John McAlusa also, owns this team, runs it. And let's say hi to Gabby and Ethan, I forgot last time.
A bit tight on time, but James Skua, excellent run, got in there. His dad was on the radio engineer in this car, so a great performance by this Miracle Motorsports team. Lee?
Young man from Georgia starting to really make an impression in sports car racing, isn't he? And this is one of the big talking points. Anthony Lazzaro, Ralph Killen has had more seconds than they would care to talk about in the ALMS. Finally, Brian Sill, they have a victory.
Ralph Kellner started the Ferrari, he ends in the Ferrari, and the other thing, you end the Porsche winning streak in the GT class. Ralph, it looks like you guys have finally found the legs underneath this Ferrari.
Yeah, I guess it's about time that we start winning. We've been trying for a long time, and it looks like for the last couple of races, the luck was not on our side, but finally we got some luck, and I'm looking forward to the season. I think we're going to have some great fights with the Porsches, yeah.
I do believe they'll have great fights indeed. You heard him say they found the luck. It takes luck to win championships, and it may be on their side now, Lee.
And they just kept working and working with that car. Great combination of Lazzaro and Kellners. And Ralph told Dorsey and I earlier in the weekend, didn't he, Dorse, that he said, Mid-Ohio, we had nothing. Here, I think we do.
Yeah, and he did too, didn't he?
Absolutely. Well, these folks can go home satisfied after witnessing the 50th ALMS event. It was one to remember that. Dyson will feel a little disappointed to be denied victory by less than 2 seconds, but they certainly fought hard.
They fought hard. That was a well-won race by the Audi champion, Audi guys. You know, I've driven for both these teams. They're both fiercely competitive teams. Hats off to them. They put on a really good show for these fans today.
Final thoughts? Enjoy it?
Yeah, of course I enjoyed it. That was great.
It was, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Thrilling stuff. There's James Weaver. He really worked hard in the early stages of the race. And the July 4 weekend celebration certainly was that. It didn't get off to a good start for the BAM boys. Wet weather at the beginning of this race had a few people scratching their heads, particularly those guys who ended up in the swamp, but they came back, bounced back. Frustration for Werner, but in the end, he was able to enjoy a wonderful victory. A week off for the ALMS, and we hope you can join us on CBS from Infineon Raceway. On behalf of Brian Till and Calvin Fish and Dorsey Schrader up here in the booth, I'm Lee Diffie. We certainly hope you enjoyed this live sports car racing from Lime Rock Park. It was the first time for the ALMS, and it was one to remember.